Throw gang, we are joined by the gorped out Grinch, Lauren Schlossman, Rudolph the red-eyed reindeer, Chuck Franco from the weed, and little drummer boy, Sean Mervana. And last but not least, all I want for Christmas is jawnz, James Harris. Welcome to the weekly running of the boys with today's full episode only available on patreon.com/throwingfitsboys. How we doing?
Sick, what dude. Up? I'm hyped, dude. I'm hyped to review the year that
the
was.
The year baby. That was. Yeah. Lawrence, why don't you hit us with the fit check, and maybe you can, you know, offensive or quarterback this shit and keep it quick, because we got to get to the entirety of the most ass year in recent history.
Yeah, let's start with you, James, since you're wearing, well, let's not spoil it, so why don't you just fucking kick it off?
All right, Subi's on the feets to make the year complete. Stussy sweats, my most reliable John of the year. Hanes panties, my mate, Fraser Croft, foreign currency, the Charlie XCX joint. Chuck, I don't know. Do you have this?
Yeah, come on now.
Fire. And then to top it all off, the piece de resistance, the Barracuda X engineered garments, courtesy of the DMA homie, Chris Corrado. Yeah. I have no idea when this is out. I was like, yo, is this under NDA? Because he told us some fucking shit.
And embargo.
I was like, this is under NDA, right? And he's like, no, go off. And Larry, yours is in my closet. I've been farting on it nonstop since I got it yesterday.
I was gonna say, I wish it was under embargo, because this is a great John, but the fact that you and I have the exact same Carol Baskin fucking, what is it, fleece faux fur?
It's like a poly faux fur G9 Harrington jacket. It's their, like, you know, shit that goes it's like what James Dean wore, except, you know, it's much more flamboyant.
Been going, will continue to go. I have not been hands-on with mine, but I was hoping that you and I would be wearing them in the next pod, which I think we're going to be doing in person. At that point, you will have been cured of coronavirus, but, you know, whatever. Yeah. You're busting your nut now without me, so it is what it is. Thank you, James. Let's kick it to Chef, who has a super professional setup courtesy of his karaoke-loving mother.
Yeah, shout out to my mom. I got the Subies on the feet, some anonymous ism socks. I'm actually wearing, on top of that, some APC denim. Don't kill me.
Petite standards?
What's up? Yeah, petite new standards. I don't know. I found them in my closet because I'm back at home right now.
Wait, what are they from? When you were like a teenager?
They're from when I was in high school. I've been almost the same size since then. These have stretched, sure. So like they still fit pretty well. I'm thinking
still
about
a little drummer
back.
Boy.
Wait, why? I'm surprised you dumped them, because like you typically wear like skinnier.
Yeah, I just stopped wearing denim for a while though. Like I haven't really worn like dark raw.
Plus the racism
in a minute.
Yeah, yeah.
Skinny Mike and Mary's like you skate.
Yeah. Are the fades sick? Did you get sick fades before you abandoned them?
Show us the combs.
I've abandoned my boy.
Show us the honeycomb.
There's some pretty
bro.
Cool.
You got whiskers. You got whiskers on your dick. Yeah, you got honeycomb. Yeah, yeah. You have like behind the fucking knees.
You have like an iPod shuffle outline.
Tobacco.
Burt's Bees tin. The circular one.
A condom.
Nah, fuck that.
Yeah, what is there a phone fade from like a whatever generation fucking?
No, I didn't. I actually I didn't wear these that much when I had them too, because they were a little too big for me back then. So yeah,
the petite new standards were
wow, dude. The only man too petite for petite standards. You know what I'm saying?
But yeah, and then I also have a foreign currency shirt on. Shout out Fraser.
Fraser.
And, Patagonia flannel.
Very nice. What's all this then?
Chuck.
I'm barefooted. I'm wearing Eric Emanuel shorts and Uniqlo underwear and my favorite Edgar Gonzalez tee.
Which one is your favorite of the 86
this
you
one.
Own?
You have so okay. many.
This one.
What is that? The dark green?
It has all the chairs on it. No, yeah, it's black.
Chair. Okay, the chair joint.
Yeah.
The Zoodboard okay. tee.
All thank right. you. And then finally, myself, I am wearing Subus as well. I'm wearing Supreme Hanes socks. I am wearing the same Mont Italy fatigues I was wearing last week. Got them courtesy of my favorite podcast's most recent debut, I guess, Private Sale. I love them. They're amazing. I don't know what sizes are still available. Could not recommend a better pant right now. I believe our code still works. Oh, shit. It closes on Christmas, doesn't it?
Yeah, so depending on when this episode comes out.
Yeah, we might be dropping this early. Either coming out Christmas Eve or Christmas, either way. Throwing Fits is the gift that keeps on giving, not just the only podcast that matters. I have on one of my many vintage Fleetwood Mac tees. I believe this is also from 1990s Behind the Mask tour. I have on a All Cops are Beautiful.
Bozos.
Yeah, all right. Bozos, which will that will be more clear later. Courtesy of the homie Tyrell Winston. And I don't know about you guys, but I'm drinking a chilled Pinot Noir in my very seasonal green Christmas glass.
Oh yeah. I got
very
a
seasonal
Modelo and okay. Some Pellies.
Nice. James, what's beer. That? Is that a Belgian white as per
yes,
usual?
Yes, sir. From Bells. From Cums Dick, Michigan.
Okay. Chuck, are you drinking anything or no?
Just some water.
Nice. Staying hydrated. That's complete fit check, baby.
All right. 2020. Most ass year in probably ever, right?
Shit sucked. Shit sucked for sure.
We're going to do a year in review. Just running through categories. It's not fuck with, not fuck with. It's our personal favorite. So it's really just what we fucked with in this ass year.
And
where
it's
really
posy.
It was just like
it's all posy too, right?
It was jawnz and content that fucking saved our mentals. And we're going to just go around and like kind of run through, you know, the best brands, best jawnz, best collabs, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, which is weird because like we were doing our research and I don't know if it's that we're early, but it seems like a lot of like sites and magazines that would normally do this maybe don't do this anymore. And I think it's because they don't want to piss people off by excluding them. And maybe. Also just because so much shit happens now. Like we spent an hour and a half just kind of making sure that we were hopefully not missing anything. And then, yeah, we're going to go through our personal favorites, not just like who had the best brand, but really what connected with us.
Yeah, what matters to
the
boys.
Our nicest brands like TV shows, sneakers.
Celeb style.
Most stylish celebrity, favorite, you know, music, and biggest bozo of the year. And then we're going to turn it over to you, the Throw Gang. We're going to tally up your fits in the first annual Fitty Awards for 2020, where you're going to tell us. You're going to tell us what you're fucking with. I guess
we're gonna drop a survey on Patreon for the patrons. That'll be out on like Monday. We'll give you guys like, I don't know, 72 hours or some shit to fill that out. Then we will recap and share the results on that. I think it's New Year's Day will be when that Patreon drops. So that'll be like the ultimate bow on the turd. We can hopefully fucking move onwards and upwards. But yeah, for the most part, this is going to be like positive favorites.
Personal
obviously, there
favorite.
Is personal favorites.
Because what is throwing fits? Yeah. What is throwing fits without the Throw Gang?
Cool.
I would die for Throw Gang, and I would die for the Groms. Sure. We're going to start with you guys, the Groms, in our first category. Your personal favorite, John of the Year. Who wants to go first? Let's go with Chuck. Chuck,
yeah, don't
you're up
jump
first,
out
buddy.
Of your seats, boys.
Well, I think the pant of the year was the Gorecki Cargo. I think that was like a very
are you a proud owner?
Yeah. I have the hiking pants, but I really want the Costin Green ones that are coming out. That color is just it kind of reminds me of like the EG pants that I always wanted and never could afford to pull the trigger on. And the Gorecki's I think are cheaper. So I'm definitely going to grab a pair of those, but just like every color that dropped was just
and they
super
moved.
Fire.
And they moved.
Yeah.
Without spoiling too much, 18 East is absolutely a brand that is available to select for the Throw Gang in the Fitties. Again, that'll be dropping on Patreon on Monday. And yeah, I'm with Chuck. It's not like the Gorecki's. I have a pair. I am a proud owner, and they got a lot of run early on in Quar.
Bro, when we put up a pair for a raffle.
Oh, that's right. Well, those were the
crazy. I mean, that was like one of 10. And
Voltron
also like,
pair. That was amazing.
Yeah, and it was when like people were most enthusiastic about, you know, raising money and activism. But it was they went nuclear.
Yeah.
I think it was like we got like $22,000 before getting any sort of match.
We're talking about pants. Alone. This is on pants.
Pants!
Pants! Talking pants. I mean, everyone expects like, you know, the Union Jays, which James and I, you know, pulled out of the fucking archives and put on the fucking auction block. You expect that to do fucking big Bs. And I believe that raised like 50 Gs. But for a pair of cargo pants to do half that, maybe two-thirds. I don't remember the exact fucking stats, the exact maths.
Our accountant was impressed. That's all on our 2-hour call with the our accountant, he was impressed.
I think that's
he's like, wait, pants?
Yeah, that's pants. That speaks to the power of not just
power of the
Gorecki's and 18 East, but really Antonio's fucking beautiful mind. Chef, what about you? What was your personal favorite John of the year?
My personal favorite John of the year. I mean, it's a tie between two of the things that I wore the most this year. One being the Hill City shorts that we
Dark Horse.
Those are good.
Yo, honorable mention, salute. RIP
Hill City. It's a fire, John. I wore them like I probably wore them more days than I did not. So,
Jeff, they're literally in my honorable mention. They're not like John of the Year, but they're in my honorable mentions because it really was like what I wore every single day over the summer, and also it was just the perfect material, perfect weight, perfect length, 5-inch inseam, and then it was very much when like New York kind of was let out again, and we could like chill in the park, and those were like my go-tos.
No, yeah, they're fucking sick. And if we're trying to step it up a little bit, then I also did buy those Anwander nylon climbing shorts too, like earlier this summer, that I think also like were a fave. That if I wasn't wearing the Hill City shorts, I was probably wearing those. So
love them.
Yeah, those two.
Both shorts kind of, well, the Anwander ones for sure. The Hill City ones, I think, on the fringe, definitely. And we'll get to trends later, but that I think is 20. 20 Gorp in action, no pun intended, right?
Did you wear those Anwander shorts to my rooftop when we drank like 6 bottles of wine in the name of research and development when we thought we were going to make a natty?
No, those were some Stone Island shorts, actually.
Oh, yeah.
But
what a classic night. We FaceTimed Chuck and he had no pants on, like straight up Winnie the Pooh.
That night, rock, it was like 5 p.m.
That the only way that memory would have been better is if Chuck was actually there. But obviously you were predisposed. I think you were out of town.
Me?
I think it was just like still like a little.
Yeah, I was afraid.
You were shook. Shook ones. Park 69.
All right. So honorable mention for me, what were the Hill City 5-inch shorts? I think I do think that this was the most unique and interesting and fun and like, I mean, maybe not fun, but like interesting summer. Probably of our lives.
People lost their lives.
And I will always, but then at the same time, New York was in a very celebratory moment at the end of the summer when we kind of like flattened the curve before like shit up, you know, when left.
We thought
we had them. Thought we had them. It's four quarters.
Yeah.
You got to play all four quarters.
Damn, we thought we had them. Shit is in overtime.
Yeah, so I will always associate the shorts with that very interesting time in like New York. You know, global personal history. And then also kind of the same shit, like my Stussy sweats. These have been my Grease Goblin go-tos.
Another trend.
This whole work from home ordeal, you know, from like early spring when it was still cold out to like fall and winter. And these are like, you know, running errands in these, going gummo in the crib. And yeah, I mean, they're so good. I even wore them in the fucking loafers photo shoot. Like that's how much I like these. But
awesome.
I got to toss the crown to, a sleeper John in one of my favorite collabs of the year, which is the Our Legace Workshop Stussy Aloha shirt, which I wasn't even pursuing it. But then Yoakum putting us on Flow Team, you know, that's special because like that's the homie and that's like my favorite brand. And then also it was so unexpectedly such a fire fit and such an amazing color where it's this like in between blue and green that kind of goes with everything. I won't wear a lot of colors with blue and I won't wear some colors with green, but this kind of just works with everything. And like the drape, the weight of it, you know, whether or not Aloha shirts like around next summer, I'm still gonna be wearing that shit.
Yeah, for sure. That's a
classic. Both like a combination like sentimentality and also just like pure like form and function.
It's nice to hear horny Jimmy get emotional on mic.
I cry.
There was a lot of fucking bottoms, a lot of hind quarter covers shouted out. I'm kind of on the other end of the spectrum, not even just with shirts, but with outerwear. Obviously, there's some recency bias here, but this was tough for me. I bought two and was flowed one, all amazing pieces of outerwear. My Supreme Barber, which I bought, which I'll kind of, I think, get to later in another category. Was one of the things I bought. I bought an amazing, perfect vintage Carhartt Detroit jacket, which I will kind of shout out more when it comes to my favorite trend of the year. And then I think my favorite John, and I've been wearing it a lot, is I got the Drake's Raglan Sleeve Overcoat. Shout out the homies at Drake's. This is a big ticket piece of outerwear. It's getting a ton of run right now. So yes, there is recency bias, but this is something that I saw, and I know James loves to fucking dig at me for begging, for lusting after stuff, and then thirstily begging for it. And I don't normally do that, but this one,
you mentioned your thirst more than I do. At this point, I think it's your own insecurity.
Well, for this, I, you know, this is, I put the fucking message in the bottle. I fucking cast it into the ocean and
send email.
You know, there was no way that this guy wasn't going to end up on my back, whether I was going to have to pay full price, half price, no price, whatever. Luckily for me, because I am fucking John Legend, it was free 99. My John of the year is my Drake's Raglan Sleepover Coat.
All right. Fire. Is Drake's your personal favorite brand of the year? Moving on to the next topic. Actually, let's keep it consistent. Let's throw it to the Groms.
Sure.
Chef, we'll go to you first. Personal favorite brand of the year. And again, personal favorite. This isn't like who had the best year, who had like the biggest fucking collab, who had the best marketing. It's what did you fuck with the hardest in 2020?
Yeah. And, you know, we kind of briefly talked about this before. If I really had to go with my favorite brand of the year, I'm going with Topo Chico. I know it's not clothing.
Wow. Damn.
Shout out Anna. No, Topo Chico got me through some shit this year, dude. We were fucking pounding like, you know, 5 or 6 bottles a day. But if we're talking clothes though, I mean, you guys know I really fuck with Oralee. I mean, it's kind of expensive, so I can't always cop it, but I just love all of the shit that they've been putting out. I
think, you know, how I've gotten familiar with Oralee via the homies at Seasons. Have you had the Topo Chico hard seltzer?
I haven't had the hard seltzer yet. No. Is it available in the States? I don't
Maybe in your region right now, right? Wasn't it on the hitting the West Coast first?
Your region, yeah.
That's what I heard.
Why don't you check your local region?
Oh, man.
All right, so Oralee.
Smoking a Jay-Z pre-roll.
I love what Chef did there because, you know, as our patrons and listeners of the pod would know, when we hit fuck with not fuck with the people, and we've kind of moved away from this, but it was always like not just fashion brands, like brands that affect your life. And Chef fucking took that rock and was like, hey, listen, at the end of the day, Topo Chico saved my life. So shout out, fashion or otherwise, respect.
Sipping burps. Oralee, though. Yeah. So you got your hands on any?
I bought that orange blouson that I sent to you guys like earlier this year too. That was like, that was one of the first quarantine cops that I made, what's up?
Big ticket item.
Yeah. I mean, again, shout out to the homies at CHCM. I copped it through them. It was like discounted a little bit. But yeah, no, I fucking love it. I can't wait till spring where I wear it all the time.
I would like to say we do not have store of the year as a category, but I think if we were to include that even right now, we're talking about Union Los Angeles, CHCM, Trebion, you know, all the homies, but CHCM definitely, I think they were featured in the last Dumper, their 10th anniversary merch is out now. So shout out 10 years of probably like the ultimate, if you know, you know, shop. So if you haven't peeped the Dumper, you know, we want to support independent retailers who have good taste and who push the culture forward. And that is absolutely CHCM.
Chef, I'm seeing a lot of alignment between you and me because Oralee is another one of my honorary mentions where it's like the emerging Japanese brand that like get it while you can now. Before it becomes, or not before it becomes, because like, you know, whatever. We all want people to like, we're not gatekeeping here, but it seems like it's bubbling up beneath the surface and it's about to fucking pop.
Well, shit's not cheap. We should say that shit is not cheap, ladies and gentlemen.
It is not cheap.
But yeah, man, CHCM's been stocking them all year. That's how I found out about them like earlier on this year. And I've just
CHCM, so like what Warren's saying is if you want any indication, everyone's like, yo, like what brands are next? What brands are next? Go to the fucking stores. And I've been saying this all year. Like, go to the store, sign for the newsletters, because these are the actual experts and curators that are like, they're literally buyers, right? They decide what they're going to stock in their stores. And CHCM was early on Oralee. And like, you see it in other, you know, the best doors around the world. So like, that's how you know. Yeah. If you can't get your hands on it, at least that's how you know. Like, it gets the ultimate global cosign.
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
Absolutely. Sick. Chuck. Yeah.
Favorite brand of the year, personally speaking, for me,
it's a two-way tie, and these are they're kind of people, not brands, but Edgar Gonzalez and Fraser.
Oh, wow!
Put out I love a fucking t-shirt and
a teasman. I mean,
Yeah. Edgar obviously donated a lot of money to undocumented people, and Fraser like was doing more with like the foreign currency thing and like putting out playlists and stuff. And you know, we're on WhatsApp all the time talking about music, but
yo, when are you going to do a playlist for foreign currency?
I don't know, but I posted a baby picture of myself recently that my mom sent me, and he was like, yo, we're going to use this for the artwork when you do one. So I am going to do one, I think. But
oh, kind of like Lil Wayne, like Carter 3 type deal.
Yeah. Teardrops and shit.
Yeah.
Get an Edgar Gonzalez chair tattoo on your eye.
Wait, Chuck, can you pressure Fraser to come on the pod? I know James and I have like made some overtures. I don't know
if he wants to.
Do you think he wants to remain
behind the scenes? I don't know.
Really?
I don't know.
He's one of those guys.
He did a Chuck's fucking vibe check happy hour like half naked in his bed. I feel like he would definitely pod. I mean, fingers crossed, that'll be a classic, bro. The British pods. Danny proved that when lads on tour, lads on mic, instant blastic every fucking time.
Mate, come on the fucking pod, mate.
Mate. Fraser, mate. Okay. I like that, Ty. James, what about you? What is your personal favorite brand?
I mean, it's always Needles. But two breakout brands for me.
Death, Taxes, Needles being the brand of the year.
Yeah. two breakout brands that really kind of like captured my attention. South to West 8. They really made me understand, Lawrence, why you're so into stolen valor, right? Like, did I go fishing at all in 2020? No. But did I dress like a fucking baller who was like with his 10 car rod in, you know, Montana? Yes. And I think that South to West 8 really developed beyond just like bags and like technical vests and like their shirting, their outerwear, their shorts. It all has these like crazy functions that, you know, do relate to the sport of fishing, but it also just looks so fucking good. And also because it's kind of still under the radar, shit went on sale and was easy to snap up. The other one is Post Imperial, my guy Nii. We linked up in February and he walked me through the collection that is like kind of in stores or online now, available to cop now. That was highlighted in GQ today. And I just felt like he was clearly about to have his moment and was like, yo, I did like shirting. I did like a few things and this is my full collection, my biggest collection ever. I've got the right interest. I'm having the right conversations. And then COVID hit him like a fucking, you know, whirlwind.
Like a bulldozer with a wrecking ball attached.
Yeah. So he kind of like had his shit set back, but he's doing some really interesting things where it's like a focus on fabric, working with like dyers and textile makers in Nigeria and other countries in Africa, but then also assembling it here in New York. And it's just fucking gas. Like it's real. Like go look at the GQ story.
He's bubbling for sure.
The two or three joints I have from him are just like, you know, I love them. But this was the year that my all-time favorite brand, Our Legace, really stepped into the fucking spotlight. And like fellow Galaxy visionaries, we've been ride or die with OL for a minute now. Finally, the fucking Philistine mainstream, like Lawrence, saw the vision and recognized it, whether it's through a collab with Stussy, whether it was through all the workshop stuff they're doing currently with like North Face.
They are running the fucking score up.
Satisfy
right now
running
for the holidays.
And
it's insane.
And ROA, ROA, District Vision, what else? Just like their in-house artists doing shit. Everything they're doing, I think like kind of fell in line with what people started fucking with. Like Workshop has been their upcycling program for I don't know how many years now. And that's like Yoakum's passion project. And this is the year that upcycling became like a true fucking thing, thanks to like Nicole McLaughlin, sure, Reese Cooper, Workshop, Levi's, all these guys. So Legace to me, you know, always been the number one. And I think this year, not only was it my number one, but I think that this year was really like they stepped into it and they did it right. It's not like nothing was corny, nothing was like overplaying their hand or anything. I mean, the shirting still is fucking fire. The pants are fire, the outerwear, everything. So
the shoes. I mean, the boots, I mean, goddamn, they speak for themselves.
The boots are big. The Cuban heels are a fucking slapper. They have their own mule, which I cannot literally walk in. I have like 7 pairs of Monos. Chef, I know you bought a pair earlier this year. You were hoping to wear them all spring and summer. COVID put an end
well,
to
you
that.
Thought wrong, bitch.
They're
they
fucking
got some work.
Yeah, the
your calves got some workout.
Yeah. The workshop Burks that I have. So yeah, you know, yeah, front to back.
I think sometimes the obvious answer, like for James and Noel, is the right one. And I think for me, it's a similar thing. Like, you know, people are going to accuse me of being a homer, but I think Ame this year, you know, really, I think solidified how I felt about Teddy and his team and what they've been building, you know, kind of since the jump. Back when I was at the Pins covering them, I think that this is the year that you have like the streetwear unicorns, first with Supreme, then with Stone Island. And I think it proves that when you do things right and you do things with integrity and you stick to your guns, like you can really thrive in a landscape that, listen, it's crowded, it's muddied, there's a lot of fucking bullshit. And I think that what Ame did specifically with that fall winter collection, of which, yes, I understand I wasn't a lookbook, I understand that I am a homer for these guys, these are friends, these are family, but I think that the barrier of entry, not necessarily in the prices, because, you know, this stuff is well made, it's expensive, but this inclusivity that I think they bring to the table and the kind of aesthetic, the grown man streetwear that they are pushing, not from any place but a truthful one, because like that's how those guys dress, that's how they want to see people dress, like that just really resonated with me and kind of, you know, hammered home the point that
you think,
you know, I've been fucking with them for a reason, and I think that they proved it with that, and I just love that energy, man. In a year of shit, that was like the most fun thing I've worked on that wasn't TF related. I could not imagine anybody more worthy of success than those guys. And you know, again, call me a fucking fanboy, call me a homer, whatever. Though, just like credit where credit's due.
Do you think much that I was saying, where like OL has kind of like always been consistent, and for whatever, like all the stars aligned for them this year? Do you think that ALD, like the marketplace, is kind of caught up, or actually? On the brand side, like the brands have all fucking swerved trying to, like, you know, chase trends or whatever, and ALDs kind of remain consistent.
Yeah.
And then we saw like the audience kind of arrive, or at least a significant amount of audience arrive 100%. At that place where they've kind of always sat at, which is just like the Wet Bandits, right?
Yeah. Their intersection, they've been at the intersection, I think, of like a lot of various, you know, kind of cultural movements and styles. And I think that they're doing the same thing that they've been doing. And I think that, yeah, the market has arrived towards, it's just like us, right? You're creating the zeitgeist, not necessarily trying to follow it like a lot of these other brands. And you know what? Even if things swerve in another way, they're going to keep doing what they have always done, what they have always done specifically at a high level. And I really think that they are, when we look back in 5 years, 10 years, and we count the Supremes and the Stone Islands, and we, they're yeah, right. I mean, shit, God willing. And, I think we're going to count them amongst those, again, unicorns, you know, brands that
what sold for $1 billion.
Listen, man, who knows?
All right.
Mark my words. That's my brand of the year, baby.
All right. I think the obviously most notable collaboration in the Throwing Fits universe was Lawrence X Ame. It was a three-way. It was Pepper X Lawrence X.
Yeah. Ame, it's Pepper's Leon world. We're just living in it, baby.
This was the year where collaborations went fucking bananas. And I mean that in the worst way possible. Where this was jump the shark collaboration, where we all saw this coming, but we couldn't even fucking remember. It felt like everybody was just collaborating with everybody for the sake of it being like a PR or marketing moment, right?
Cold, hard cash, dude.
Yeah, everything was just a short-sighted cash grab where it's like, oh, yo, you have a brand partnerships guy? Oh, you have a brand partnerships guy? Let's fucking link and build, fam! And so the amount of fuckery when it came to collabs was just like next level. It was hard to sift through this shit. I mean, before getting into specifics, I really do think that this was when like collaborations have jumped the shark.
They suck. I mean, you and I spent fucking an hour and a half putting the survey together, really trying to make sure that no stone was left unturned for the Throw Gang so that they could really make their voice heard, because every vote counts. And not that there's like a ton of collabs here, and whatever, we wrote down like the 10 most notable. They're, at least in my opinion, for the most part, I bought like nothing from the majority of these. I was excited by barely any of these. And who knows how many we fucking missed, because you can't even keep track at this point. It's criminal. Yeah, and this is not even counting sneaker collabs, which we saved for sneakers specifically. Yeah.
Every notable sneaker was a fucking collab.
Yes, exactly.
And that just speaks to the fact that, like, whatever makes them, it's really just a noise making moment. That's all these collaborations are for the most part. Like, and that's what makes it hard to kind of
marketing. It's marketing. It's marketing. It's bullshit. It's fake. Bullshit. It's Fugazi.
But we are keeping it posy. So,
Chuck. Yeah, right. We're super positive.
Who are we going to? I guess, Chef, what's your personal favorite collaboration of the year?
I mean, this one, I have two. One of them was super easy, which was Legace and Stussy. I mean,
all right, we're just gonna have the same answers for everything, huh?
Yeah, dude. I mean, yo, that's the only shit that I've set an alarm for, you know, to wake up at like 5 in the morning.
Your enthusiasm for the workshop Stussy collab was A, infectious, B, a little annoying.
I'm sorry, man, you're
my competitor. But ultimately, no, it's cool to like see you.
Didn't
actually
you have him buy you stuff?
I know, I copped all of your shit for you,
dude. Yeah, you're a dick, dude.
you're partying or something and couldn't wake up.
It's so annoying how I made Chef wake up at 4 in the morning to buy me stuff. Yeah. Like, what are you talking about?
No, and then you bought a bunch of stuff, got delivered to me, and I like listed on
you thought it was yours.
Damn, dude. Honestly, the worst collab of the year is James Time Chef, dude. That shit was fucked since Jump Street.
No, for real, like Chef, like if I go back in our personal one-on-one text communications, because I have to find your login info for Zoom, so we can record more than 40 minutes. It's really just us talking about like music and like New Yorker profiles and our legacy workshop and Stussy.
Yeah,
you guys are cool. I mean, it's cool that you can like find a fellow jawnz enthusiast when it's so specific to like a single project. Because Lawrence, you and I, like, I'm not gonna text you.
No,
about,
I know. You and I barely like any of the same shit. I'm just saying, like, this is why the Throw Gang is ride or die for us, because we have created a community around jawnz enthusiasts.
Exactly. So, all right, dude. Chef, so you're collab of the year.
Yeah. So our legacy workshop in Stussy, and I think another one where I didn't actually get to buy anything from this, but I just liked the way that it looked, and I don't think it was like talked about a lot, but the Ralph and Beams collaboration that happened this year, I thought
Beams
it was
Plus.
Also like,
yeah, right.
Yeah, there was like that, some very, very dope stuff in that. So I think those two are my
favorite. Dude, Beams notoriously is an amazing collaborator for, obviously, Arc'teryx is like the big fucking, you know, Gorp Grail. But yeah, I think that you could probably create an entire wardrobe around Beams Plus collabs. And Chef, you're right. That one was definitely overlooked, partly because I don't know if that was even available readily, at least in the States at all.
No, it was really hard to get out here.
Didn't Nordstrom have
maybe? I think, of course. Shout out Sam, shout out Gian.
I think also the timing was, it was pre-Gian, so shout out Sam, mate. I think the timing was right before COVID too, so it was like unfortunate. It was like early Jan, Feb, March maybe.
Bummer.
Yeah, but those are mine.
Sleep. All right. Chuck, favorite collab?
I think, well, I have two. One happens every year a lot, but the first one, Kith
Lucky Charms.
Yeah, Cinnamon Toast Crunch. No, the first one is the 316. I should have picked that one. The 316 18 East, that like liner jacket that they did.
Yeah, it was sick.
It just seemed like the perfect. Like both brands, it was like 50% each brand. Like it just seemed like a very true, like
the division indigo, of labor was very much split down the middle.
Yeah, like that indigo color was like just seemed so signature to what 316 does. Denim, ever heard of it? But then
Jeff.
Like that and
also
pocket.
it was a nice little like nod to 316 opening their shop on Elizabeth Street, just literally a block down from 18 East, and kind of like them. It was like a
welcome to the neighborhood.
Yeah, it was like a community neighborhood forming moment.
People helping people type beat.
It's like this block, this street's the best street now, and this John is celebrating it.
I don't want to say Cloud Corridor, but
the new Cloud Corridor.
New Cloud Corridor.
Elizabeth Street?
Where it used to be Howard Crosby.
It was Howard.
Oh, right.
Howard, Crosby Street, and then Howard.
John.
Where Stadium Goods is.
That's Lil Amsterdam. you can get famously weed there very easily. But the other one was, and the week it came out, I was really bummed because I couldn't make the boys only and it wasn't talked about. But the most recent Supreme North Face collab was fucking sick.
The Grinch joint.
The fuzzy Nupsy was so sick.
It was a banger.
The juicy foozy.
Yeah, I really like that jacket, but yeah, I mean
the juicy noopsy.
I feel like whenever they collab, I'm either like very underwhelmed or like I'm borderline like I want to try to do everything I can to buy it, and this was one of those times.
What colorway was your favorite?
I mean, the green one's cool. Like, if I had all the money in the world and a bunch of jackets, I would get the green one. But the black, I would have probably tried to get the black one.
So I was looking. I'm embarrassed to admit that I was trolling StockX, and because obviously I want the Grinched out green. But the black is the one that's reselling for the most.
Wow, damn.
Yeah, murdered out fur. Yeah, that's a banger for sure. Both awesome choices, Chuck. One quick point, because I think where we would go to James next, but I do want to say that I think that while that was a banger collab from the North Face, the Gucci North Face that just dropped really, to me personally, feels like the nail in the coffin of Gorp. Even though both of these brands rock, to keep this topical, I thought that shit looked cheap as fuck, and like I tweeted, it deserves to be an H&M, which is a bummer because...
You're talking about Gucci.
Yeah, Gucci North Face. It just felt, I don't know, I thought it would look super cheap, and I was super underwhelmed. And I was bummed because I literally, speaking of fucking North Face, I just got myself the standard Nupsy in green. Yo,
oh, shit.
I didn't realize that, you know, at least if you live in New York, it's basically fucking impossible to buy a Nupsy. Mm-hmm. But I tracked one down.
You got a Nupsy hustle.
Yeah, exactly, the RIP. Not as good as the fucking, this is why I was looking on StockX for the Grinch Supreme
joint.
Did
you see the video of someone shaving their Supreme North Face?
No! What?
What?
They had clippers.
They buzzed it?
Oh.
Damn, why didn't you steal that and put it on IG, dude?
They gave That's it a so fade. Funny. I think my dad sent it to me, actually.
they faded the Supreme North Face. Oh, damn, dude, we should take one to Mildred for content, bro.
Yeah, that's hilarious.
Can I expense that? Shit. Okay. All right, James.
We'll get it. Okay, we'll get this Gucci North Face. So I got two. One, honorary mention, Uniqlo plus J, the return. Mm-hmm. When was the last time that they did this?
2014, I think, was the last time. It's been asleep and only now just was awakened after a minute.
Awake the Kraken.
Did you cop anything from that?
Well, Janice, the homie, she sent over a fucking grip. My first ever turtleneck, which I'm excited to...
first ever as a 34-year-old man?
Yeah, first... a long sleeve black turtleneck. Yes, I'm excited to wear this to my favorite jazz bar.
Yeah, it was making you look like a fucking sprocket, dude.
But the parka, bro, I feel like I was wearing fucking acronym.
Yo, that sold out. That shit fucking flew. That was like a hype John.
Dude, so it's
and if Janice, if you're listening, I did not flip mine on grilled.
Oh, well, me neither. I actually didn't. I wear mine constantly.
I didn't either.
Oh, okay. It's like acronym EG in that like I'm still discovering new pockets. You know what I mean? Like,
oh shit, yeah.
And like,
well, the lining was crazy. I mean, that was plus J is so Jill Sander is such a motherfucking genius. And this is no shade to the Myers who do Jill Sander now, because I think that they're doing their own fucking amazing shit, but she is so fucking dialed in that like the fact that she just hasn't been, it's almost like depriving the people when she's not designing, because I got that parka too. And I was like, yo, this is an insane garment to just pick up at Uniqlo at the mall.
And you look like a fucking, SWAT team, like assassin, right? So you look cool. And then it's just so functional. Like I was wearing it out on like a pre-COVID, pre-exposure, on the fucking windiest day of the year on my roof, and I didn't feel a goddamn thing.
Yeah, amazing. Amazing.
Great.
Fucking garment.
But I got to bring it back to our Legace Workshop Extusi, because unlike 99% of collaborations, which are just marketing moments, this truly was one party bringing their capabilities and resources to the table and another party bringing their capabilities and resources to the table and finding a way to create something that otherwise would never exist. In this case, it was the upcycling dudes at Workshop going into Stussy factories, finding dead stock fabrics from the 90s, taking bolts of reams of fabric and creating, you know, in some cases, super limited runs of Johns that were very Arlagache, but in Stussy early 90s surfer fabrics. And that's just something where it's like you get very little of that in collaborations anymore, where it's like, yo, this is what we do. That's what you do. It's different. It's similar. We're going to find a way to make this work and like create something new out of what is there versus just like slapping your fucking logo next to each other, you know?
Greater than the sum of its parts, right? I think that that's that across the board, as far as like the throwing fits universe and us as like, a, you know, voting almost like as a unit, that's God, I'm with you. Like that was just so well done, so fucking sick. And as much as maybe something like Ame times Drake's felt so of the moment and so where, you know, menswear, hashtag menswear 2.0 is going, or where the kind of grown ass streetwear, you know, kind of culture is moving, which we've talked about before. Like really Stussy OL was so fucking bullseye for what this podcast gets excited about, and what it represents. And I'm definitely there with you.
Is that your top though? Is that your top?
No, collab? It's not because is my it, top is it
Drake's ALD.
No, it's not. It's Supreme Barber. I mean, that to me is just like, listen, I know that was only three jackets or whatever it was, and a couple and hats as well, matching buckets. And I think it was supposed to come out. I didn't even know this, but I was doing some research. I think it was going to come out for Glastonbury, which is also so fucking sick. Speaking of the fucking lads and the mates and the geezers,
in the muck and the mud.
But to kind of what you were saying about like, you know, something that would never come out if it wasn't for the collab, like getting, well, one is that jacket, I don't know, like if any people know this, but that's a unique silhouette that was designed for that collab. That's not the classic Buford or Belford that, you know, Barber is known for, that you're going to see on the crown. That's going to be, you know, on every fucking zood board on the back of Prince Charles and Princess Diana. It was a new kind of silhouette that kind of combined the best from all these classic styles. And then obviously in that blaze orange, and then the joint that I got, that cheetah, that was the John more than any that I saw this year in the Supreme lookbook that had no information attached and was like, I don't care if this is an official Barber collab. I don't care if this is Supreme fucking biting the waxed fucking goats. Like I'm going to cop this. And then when it came out that it was a proper collab, I hit up any fucking plug that I had. Apparently they were super limited. I just feel fucking blessed to have one. And the biggest bummer for me is that I didn't get an opportunity to wear it because all fall we were locked in, which is probably why it didn't ascend to John of the Year like my Drake's coat did.
You wore it on the hottest day of the summer when we did our fucking boot shoot.
Yes, that's right. a lot of my, actually all of these top three Johns for me, all these pieces of outerwear you would have seen in official marketing materials around our two collabs, the boots or the loafers.
Yeah, for a pod that doesn't necessarily, for a podcast that does, and a group of fellas that doesn't necessarily fucking auto knob slob Jebbia and everything Supreme does, the fact that and makes fun of a lot of Supreme collabs, like the fact that two Supreme collabs are, you know, half of our four collabs of the year, that's kind of interesting. No,
what was the other one?
Chuck's Supreme North Face.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, for sure. And I will say that arguably the biggest moment Supreme had this year, Supreme times Yoji, right? Continuing their kind of legacy now of working with like
not the Supreme best Lamborghini. And
yeah, not Supreme Lamborghini, but obviously following up Supreme Louis, and then obviously Supreme JPG, and then obviously now this year with Yoji, that's going to become a part of their DNA. Yo, just real quickly to let people know how much of a drought the fucking collab game was. Some of the collabs that are on the survey that you could fucking pick if you're a fucking tasteless bozo, we have Travis McDonald's. We have Gucci North Face, which I kind of already shit on a bit. We have Fear of God Zenya, which I liked, which was, I think, very classy and speaks to some trends we'll talk about later. You had LV Squared, and you have kind of like the Drake Time Nike shit, which like for the most part, unless we're missing something like egregiously, James and I really couldn't find a lot of non-sneaker collabs, I will say. That's the one caveat that got us even remotely excited, which well, I think
got us from
the problems with the industry.
Got us remotely excited or like made a significant amount of noise. Cause like, obviously we do not give a fuck about, you know, Travis McDonald's, but that was like the that was a pop culture moment.
Sure. You're right.
Even if it was the fucking, you know, evil, multinational corporation McDonald's fucking
the late thing, stage capitalism lit. Thanos, you know, that's the infinity stone of all fucking collabs, bro.
I mean, you could arguably say that Transition God raising his hand here, but you could arguably say that collaborations are a trend in and of themselves.
Yeah.
Which brings us to
really could
personal favorite trend of the year.
Oh,
I guess we went with Chef last time. So Chuck, what was your, taking a 35,000 foot perspective, looking back at the fucking most, at the ass year that was, what was your favorite trend that of 2020?
Everyone seeing the light and coming to my side and wearing all elastic everything sweatsuits at home. Entire world stock must have gone up fucking off the fucking chart, right? Like, everyone was buying sweats and stuff because everyone's staying in.
You read that article?
The whole New York Times profile on basically them finding a second wind, but also, like, being completely unsure of what the future of the brand was, you know?
Yeah. End of the operation aspects of the industry.
Yeah, sure.
In its entirety.
So wait, Chuck, can we say that? So I guess what you're talking about is what James and I dubbed, and you'll see this on the survey, Throw Gang, is a grease goblin turbo scum work from home life is the trend.
That's perfect.
So eloquently perfect and efficiently.
Are you going to take this? I mean, obviously this is like a probably the most universal, John's trend across like the entire spectrum of enthusiasm, whether you're a fucking, peon who doesn't give a shit. All the way up to, Travis Scott. But like, Chuck, are you going to take this into post-COVID life, this fucking Grease Goblin aesthetic?
No, I'm hoping that by then I'll be ready to, for some buttons, some zippers.
some accoutrement.
Some
flair.
Some hardware.
I'll probably leave that behind. At that point, I'll probably be sick of it, to be honest. And we'll just want to like...
You're not sick of it yet.
Chuck, have you ever been like, yo... I'm going to run an errand. Guess what? I'm going to go put a big fucking fit on. Or is it just
That night, I tried to do that, and that was how I almost bled out of my ankles. That night, we went to fucking Lilia.
Almost bled out on Union Ave.
Real, dude. Damn. A fucking statistic. Damn.
So you've never had the urge to be like, yo, I want to get dressed today. There's a boys only. I might throw a fucking, G9 on. I might bring out the G6.
I might break out the fucking G9 Barracuda Harrington.
Nah.
All right.
When's the last time you wore jeans? Have you worn jeans in a calendar year?
In March, but when I was going to work still.
Sure. Okay.
But
what about what about pants without an elastic waistband?
No.
With a, as you said, button and zipper.
No. I haven't. I'm serious.
Well, I think if anything, like you can find like it's kind of like the hiking pants that you have from 18 East, a potential brand of the year for a lot of the throw game. I mean, that's a corduroy kind of gorped up hybrid. That's not like greasy, nasty, cum stained, stussy sweats from Horny Jimmy. That's Chuck, kind of like, that's somewhere Chuck, in the middle.
I want you to think about trying one thing maybe in the next week before we do our next Boys Only. Try to get a fit off next time you're like going out to like the wine shop or food shopping or buying cat food. Just try it. Just like try putting on like a shirt, a layer item, outerwear, pants, and like some shoes besides just like some slip-ons. Just try it. That's all I'm asking. And I want to see how you feel. And I would love if you could report back and just be like, yo, I felt good or I felt like horrible. I just want to know. Just a little social experiment. That's all.
I'll check the bandwidth machine and see if I can do that. Cool.
Thank you.
Chef, do you have a trend of the year?
Maybe not like an overall aesthetic trend in the way that you guys have been describing them, but I wrote down four things. Two of them I think are moot for our conversation. The first was conscious copping, which is what we kind of briefly spoke about.
Love that.
I think that I like that that's a thing now, and I like that people are just like a little bit more mindful about where their shit's coming from and who's making it.
That's great. That absolutely plays. Do not ever discount your beautiful brain.
Thanks, bro. Well, number two might.
Did I speak too soon? What's number two? That.
Number two is just picnics.
Hell yeah, dude.
I think that was a sick trend of this year. But beyond that, I think there's
picnics in your hill city.
Picnics in the Hill City. Yeah, no, 1,000%.
Hill City Park. Hill City National Park.
I wrote I wrote Harry Cardigans, but I think that, like, as Chuckles kind of talked about the North Face Supreme jackets too, I think this whole, like, the just like the super, like, fuzzy texture, like, shit that a lot of people are liking right now, I think I don't know, I'm into that. I feel like I've always kind of, like, gravitated towards, like, that.
I would say stuff. I think that's an extension from last year's obsession with fleece. I really think that it's, like, from fleece to mohair to I am literally wearing a $600 skinned Grinch on my back that I waited, you know, in line for. So I feel that. I think that's legit. Yeah, I don't know if will that keep going? Will that literally last up until we drop our fucking mohair cardigan? I don't know. Fingers crossed.
I hope so. I don't know. Also, I just think that, like, cardigans in general, I feel like haven't, like, always been cool, but now they feel like they're becoming cooler. And as a, you know,
do you think that's to do with kind of like a return to, like, I don't know, whether it's work from home, turbo scum life, or is it like the early 2000s and kind of like that fucking indie rocker shit coming back, and, you know, whether that's related to like e-boy shit?
Yeah, I think it's a multitude of things and a lot
perfect
of that
storm.
But maybe not the e-boy shit, but, like, I do think that, like, a cardigan is, in my opinion, it's one of my favorite, like, types of garments. It's just like it's warm, but you can keep it open, so it's, like, still kind of breezy. And then also, like, you know, if it's a little bit bigger, it just feels like you're wearing a blanket.
What's your go-to cardi?
Mine, I have a few. I mean, like, my favorite one is the Nanamika one that you guys have seen me wearing all the time. Yeah, but I have, like, a couple. I have a Needles mohair one that I really like. And then I have a lot of, like, old Uniqlo, like, Uniqlo cardigans that I've had since, like, high school that I still wear that are fucking, like, trashed. But they're so comfortable now because I've been wearing them for so long that, yeah, those are my faves.
They're molded to your waifish, twinkish body at this point.
Yeah, and the fabric is, like, just getting, like, a little bit old, and, like, there's, like, holes in them and stuff. But, like, it's just, yeah, I don't know. They just feel, like, yeah, again, like, wearing blankets. They're so nice.
Yeah, of course.
All right. I think those are solid. I don't think you needed to necessarily, like, you know, hedge off rip or anything. Like, those were fantastic. every social function that the four people on this Zoom have, like, engaged in together, for the most part, from what I can remember with my dog shit memory, typically revolved around at least a picnic to kick things off before
it's like outdoor eating and drinking.
Yeah, sure.
Yes.
Soak up all the booze.
What?
Yep.
Are you talking about? Never Nailed mind. It. Whatever.
You go to picnic James. Is?
James. Yeah, Chuck, have you ever been on a picnic before?
Of course.
Damn. Okay. You don't seem very...
All right, trends of the year for me, Grease Goblin, obviously, kind of like Chuck. I mean, this is kind of like a return to my natural state. Just wearing the same, like, T-shirt and...
The mud.
Yeah, just wearing the same T-shirt for, like, 4 or 5 days in a row until, like, accidentally catching a whiff and being like, oof, time for a change.
Boy.
I want to talk about Gorp for a second.
Yeah.
So Gorp, obviously. And Lawrence, you talking about North Face Gucci being the nail in the coffin of Gorp.
What did you think? What did you think just off rip? Because that literally dropped, what, a day ago? Like, what are your immediate thoughts?
I mean,
I thought it was garbage.
It's trash. And, like, I hated the way it was presented. I hated the way it was, like, Gucci-fied, right? Yeah. Who knows if Alessandro, I mean, he talks about, like, you know, finding, like, peace and
it's like hippie dippy. It's supposed to be hippie dippy, shit in, like, but nature. It didn't really hit.
But it's like hippie dippy, but in fucking, like, $1,500 jackets and sweaters and shit. So it may be nail in the coffin when it comes to kind of like the Gorp appropriation,
mainstream
high Gorp. Fashion yeah. aesthetics, and it being simply a product. And this kind of goes back to Jonah Weiner's Gorpo Boris essay that he put out.
Fantastic.
Where it's like Gorp is a trend, and that's great. And it, you know, if it gets more people outside and more people kind of like doing things and moving around, great.
And changing their mindset, right? Which is most
but important. It ultimately is just like it's about, like, you know, finding happiness outdoors, moving, doing things. Death of ego, death of like conspicuous consumption, and that's great. But in a way, this Gucci North Face being so fucking trash, hopefully it does put the nail in the coffin and people can move on if Gorp isn't truly for them. And not to be like a gatekeeper fucking poser sniper, But like, if it's not for you, then like, just don't do it. And if you were introduced to GORP and like were, did become like an outdoors enthusiast, that's great. And keep doing that. But my trend of the year, I guess, kind of is an extension of arguably the biggest trend of last year, which was like deadhead, fucking tie dye, screaming from the rooftops how much you do mushrooms, which I think the trend is microdosing, where it's not like fucking wearing full tie dye online ceramics once, you know, arrives 10 months later if you order it, but more like it's related to GORP, but it's like hippy dippy outdoorsy shit, not purely functional, but like kind of has that aesthetic where it's like Mount Sunny, Jam Store, what was the big one? I'm totally fucking blanking, but it's like,
that's fine. I've taken too many drugs, my friend.
Yeah. It's like, yo, I'm doing a cap. I'm not fucking, you know, going full balls to the wall down on Shakedown Street, you know?
Sure.
So it's kind of like a step back from like the full turbo John Mayer warship fucking deadhead style that was so huge last year. And it's kind of like bringing it down to earth a little bit.
Absolutely. I'm with you. I'm with you 1,000,000%. All the brands that you did shout out are friends of the pod. We wear them. We love them. And it definitely is like a little bit more of a, like you said, down to earth kind of take, where it's not like corny in a way that's performatively about freeing your mind to a level that is not realistic. I think
shout out the newest deadhead, Lena Dunham.
Yeah, right. Exactly. Though, yo, director of the industry pilot, which
EP, pretty sure is going to
get brought up later. My final point on potentially the death of GORP and Gucci times the North Face, I think that when I saw that, I definitely, and shout out Jonah for sure, I got, Corpo Gorpo vibes from that, right? Like that to me almost read less GORP, even though, you know, on the surface, that's what it's supposed to be, and read more like the turbocharged gaucheness that, you know, was also a trend in like brands with chrome hearts and things like that, where it's all about look how much money I spent, expensive my outfit is, and how much money I spent. And I understand that that's what Alessandro has brought to Gucci, and we low key I think have been champions of that, because when it's good, it's great. And I think that this is potentially a step over the line, and takes it to a place that, at least for me personally speaking, is not relatable, which brings me to my favorite trend/trends of the year, which is definitely, obviously, should come as no surprise, blue collar, stolen valor, salt of the earth. And I think that part of that to me, which is so appealing, also a bit of what Chef was talking about. For me personally, again, vintage has been really something that I've been, that's how I've been spending my money. That's what I've been passionate about. That's been, you know, a lot of the Carhartt that I've purchased this year has been vintage. I love that stuff. It's fantastic. I'm not a huge like upcycle guy, but the other side of that coin, if we're going to kind of group that together as a trend, on our survey, I'm definitely into spending my money on vintage and, stealing as much blue collar valor as I can.
Have you ever gotten called out? I'm curious. Like, you ever walked by a construction site and been like,
no, I have not gotten called out. With that said, have I talked about how like I feel weird, you know, being
there's like a funny TikTok where some guy's like wearing like paint splattered fucking Margiela jeans, and some other guy like gets on the subway and he's like, tough day at work, right?
Yeah.
Like, yeah, man. Yeah, my graphic design job really hurt.
Well,
my,
that's what I'm saying. Yo, tough day of work at the podcast factory. We've said it before and we'll say it again. I mean, I'm not going to pretend like that isn't problematic in its own way. With that said, I'd like to think that there are positive, you know, there's a positive fucking, you know, nature to it, which is like, you know, trying to not consume new things that are contributing to the fucking global supply chain that is destroying our planet and all the other stuff that Jonah is talking about. So for me, if it wasn't, you know, losing weight and becoming hot and rediscovering pieces already in my wardrobe, if I was acquiring new shit, it was primarily vintage. It was Carhartt. It was blue collar stolen valor. And yeah, I couldn't be more proud of.
Yeah, I mean, circumstances of being a broke boy also helped, I'm sure.
Fuck you, bitch. What's the next category?
We talked to the accountant, for 2 hours. I know your tax.
This was supposed to be positive.
Yeah, what the fuck, dude? That was a shot. Yeah. Whatever.
Lawrence, don't say fuck you, bitch. All right. One positive thing that this pod has worked tirelessly for and is like a long-term, it's like one of those 100-year projects that I think that fucking chipping away at, just fucking, you know, Tim Robbins and Shawshank Redemption with the goddamn rock nubs, the rock carving nubs, right? Slowly but surely, we are making our way towards the post-sneaker world. And just once again, to define the post-sneaker world, for all the haters and losers out there, we are not saying sneakers are going to entirely die. We're saying that you hopefully everyone discovers options outside of the fucking hype cycle, right?
Free your mind.
Loafers, boots, clogs, derbies, Belgians, whatever the fuck. That being said, sneakers will always be around. The majority of the fucking week I wear sneakers. I know everyone, that's probably the same for everyone on this podcast, except for Chuck, who doesn't wear anything because he doesn't leave the crib, and maybe Lawrence. I know you love wearing your Belgians.
Yeah.
What was everyone's personal favorite sneaker of the year? Would we start, Chef, it's you.
Yep. I'm actually like, I think all you guys know this. I'm not like the biggest like sneaker dude. So like I told you guys before, but this was like one of the harder categories for me to come up with something for. I mean, besides like the classics that I'm always wearing, like my Chucks, my Vans, like those are, you know, those are the two that are always going to be my faves. I'd say I did buy the Monos earlier this year, and I love those.
Like the rose, and like a rose pink, or like a
pink. Like a pink, right?
Yeah, they're a pink. It's like a dusty pink. I'm a big fan, and I got to wear them a couple of times over the fall too. Like I thought they were sick. But I mean, I will shout out. I don't know if this falls into this category, but I would shout out Subus, man, because like I literally feel like I haven't taken them up since I.
Those are definitely not sneakers, and you should save that for your non-sneaker footwear of the year, which I believe is coming up soon. With that said, I mean, it is like James and I were almost arguing a little bit, like is the Reebok Beatnik, is the Yeezy Foam Runner, like are these sneakers? Like what is a sneaker? What's not? For the most part, I think that. Chefs, you know, listen, I think you are the fucking poster child for a guy who's like, yo, I know the classics that I love. I am never going to be like crossing my fingers and praying to the gods that I have the opportunity to spend my money on some shit that a corporation is purposely like, you know, restricting the supply on so that I fucking, you know, become a fucking late stage capitalism cuck. And I think that really for me, what you represent there, because I know Chuck is probably the biggest sneakerhead on the pod, but I'm like probably right there with him to some degree. And I kind of almost like, yeah, I look up, I admire the way that you're just like, yo, I want fucking Vans Authentics and I want Chuck 70s and I'm going to throw in a pair of a GR, you know, Reebok Club C's and I'm good.
It's right? Admirable. It's admirable.
And you don't really need more than that. You know?
I wish I could turn that shit off. But no, so let's throw to Chuck though, arguably the most knowledgeable
our resident
sneakerhead.
Damn. Like, I feel like this could have been the answer for last year, too, and you guys literally just mentioned it, but just thinking about the Club C, like, the Eric Emanuel collab, the Jown collab was better this year. The one with the
really?
The one with the tan bottom, the gum, like, the tan hits on it.
Agree,
that one was better. The Sneeze Mag ones, the...
Sneeze were fire. Sneeze ones were fire.
The add some chocolates. Yep. Those were fucking sick. Absolutely. Like, and I think just like everything Reebok did in general, like
the Yo, can I say something though? All of these sneakers that you're talking about still fucking sold out on drop day and were hard as fuck to get. Yeah. Even though these are the, if you know you, not the Jown, but the Sneeze and the Adsum, shout out to homies Adsum, these were still hard ass sneakers to acquire, which is a fucking bummer.
Yeah. Big bummer. And as far as like, I was thinking too, like to throw in a retro, like I would have loved to get a pair of, I'm that fucking loser that's like, I couldn't get the shoes back in the day, so I'm just trying to do it, trying to buy them all now that I have money.
That's nostalgia.
But like, I would have loved to get a pair of Neon 95s in terms of talking retros. Like,
those are, aside from, aren't those reselling for like not a crazy amount?
Like, not really, but it's still more than, you know.
You should still be able to buy that shoe at retail.
What do they retail for?
Like 180?
I think they're only – well, not only. I mean, they're reselling for, I want to say, like $260,
which is still
more than you want to pay for a pair of sneakers if you want, but it's, like, not fucking, you know, $400,
$500. Yeah, but those were my...
So unfortunate, this is the fucking reality now, right?
Yeah.
Oh, that's not that bad. Only a 20% markup? Sure, yeah. Go crazy.
Yeah, but those were all the ones that... Also, just, I feel like I have to mention, I famously talked shit about New Balance on the Blackbird Spy Plane. But the dime New Balance were so fucking hard.
Hell yeah,
baby. The silver ones would have been the color for me.
The New Balance 860 V2 dime collab in silver. Said it before and I'll say it again. I'm with Chuck. One of my fucking sneakers of the year. Any other ones that you want to mention, Chuck?
Never mind.
The Sewer Stompers, too. I would have loved a pair of those.
Those Stray Rats.
The color was, I mean, because I don't know if I could do like the actual beef and broccoli boot, but I love the color. So I feel like that would have been like a nice, like,
you can do the beef and brocks. Like, you're not like, that's not that great. I mean, whatever, to each his own, but I think you could absolutely do that. But yeah.
True. But those were all the ones that I liked this year. Also, I got the Vapor Waffle. Shout out Nick for helping me. But like, those were a shoe that like, they were like at Fashion Week and we saw them like, it felt like almost a year before they actually came out. And I was like, I probably won't like them when they come out. And I still did. And I bought them.
Can I ask you a question about the Vapor Waffle? So James and I, when we were putting together the robust category of Sneaker of the Year, which again, the majority are collabs.
On the fitties. On the fitties form.
Yeah, for the fitties, for the throw gang. We left off the Sakai Vapor Waffles because we thought that, you know, there was this big hype when they debuted on the runway for sure. But we felt like versus whatever that previous Sakai Nike, they kind of paled in comparison in hype. So we left them off. Did we fuck up? Do you think they should be included?
I think that's a valid reason to leave them off.
They seemed like a little bit of a whimper versus a bang. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, but if Chuck's saying it's Sneaker of the Year, then I think that warrants it.
We'll make a note. We can amend this for sure.
Okay. It's very easily doing now. Lawrence, our second most knowledgeable sneaker guy, sneakersman. What was your Sneaker of the Year, my guy?
I mean, I truly believe that, and this has nothing to do with necessarily my rejection of the hype cycle and the big boys and Kanye and Nike and Virgil. And as much as I hate what all of that represents, I really feel, you know, fucking pound for pound, sneaker for sneaker, collab for collab, this was the year of New Balance. And within that, there was a lot of fucking great bangers in terms of collabs. Obviously, Teddy and Ame and bringing back the 550. I have the forest green. I wear them. They're amazing. There is the Salehe Bembury New Balance. What is that? The 202R. That shit. I personally respect that dude as a designer. We've talked about this on a previous podcast endeavor that will not be named, like way, 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 way deep in the fucking archive. My whole thing was like, is this dude being put on a weird pedestal because he is a minority designer? Does he actually have the chops? I love to admit that he proved me fucking wrong. Not that he even knows who I am. I think that where he's kind of ended up in just recently now leaving Versace and doing his own thing, I think that that New Balance was the best piece of footwear that he has put his hands on. I personally fucking hate the Versace chain reactions. And I'm not a huge fan of the other stuff that he's necessarily done, whether that was with Yeezy or before that with Cole Haan. But this fucking New Balance was a banger. The fabrication was amazing.
That's your Sneaker of the Year.
No.
Are you still leading up to it? All right.
I'm still leading up. I'm still doing Jesus my honorable mentions. Christ. Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
might fucking, go to the bathroom.
Let me be passionate about something. God damn, I thought we were trying to stay positive. Anyway, finally, all of this ratchets up, to the year of the 992. That's obviously what New Balance was trying to do. There was a lot of fucking bangers, most notably the two Jowns. You and I were on Flow Team. We got those. I think the green was stronger than that brown gray that I believe both of us have. There was a lot of great inline colors. The yellow one slapped, the cloud slapped, the classic gray slapped, but the best 992 of the year was the double taps 992. That, without a fucking doubt, that is my sneaker of the year.
Also my sneaker of the year. That
suck my dick, motherfucker.
Which we're not on Flow Team for, but...
No, which is weird because that's like, you and I had the privilege of being on... we have crazy New Balance Float. We did not get those, and that's a bummer.
And this is a bit of the if you know, you know, because like, The Jound obviously was the most coveted chip, but Double Taps, I think aesthetically, just like that deep, sexy brown with the little orange hit. Yeah,
fire.
I mean, the whole 992 program was just fucking front-to-back slappers.
Joe Fresh Goods?
Yeah.
A little bit of a shoe for babies.
That was on everyone's, like, top tens. Chuck, you like
really?
That?
Really?
I mean, the Salehi, I think the Joe Fresh Goods were probably my favorite.
What was your favorite 992?
Really? That was your favorite 992?
Well, the Double Taps was the 992, right?
Yeah.
Then it has to be the Double Taps. Yeah. But before we get too far away from sneakers, I would like to say the Union 4s might have been up there, but I didn't get to feel this. I would have liked to feel this.
Richard.
I didn't get to feel the suede in person. Richard. So, I guess we'll never know.
Yeah, we'll never know. That is absolutely in the survey for the fitties. James, do you have anything else to add? Because I would just love to shout out some more sneakers on here.
The New Balance Double Taps, it was fun. It's really funny that like that was both our favorite in that like we never really talked about it or like lusted after it, I would say. No. But I think just looking back, like that is the one that absolutely slapped the hardest. My only other honorable mention I would do again in the year of Stussy, or in a year where Stussy was one of the biggest brands and make doing the most, you know, because it was its 40th anniversary
comeback season, baby.
Whether you believe Stussy or whether you believe Sean Stussy on it being its 40th, who's to say? Stussy, Nike, the Air Zoom Spiridon Cage 2. Am I saying that right? I don't fucking know.
Yeah, what?
The creams. I fucked with the creams. Yeah. I love that color. I loved how like
people were dying them too and freaking them, which was very sick.
My favorite sneaker of all time, as you guys know, is the Nike Free Run 2 Plus, right? Because it's like, it's techie. It has like a mesh toe box and kind of like a chunky enough sole. And to me, this kind of like, I mean, the model in and of itself, I think is, in the same arena as that sneaker where it's like, it's weird and old and kind of chunky and terrible, but it still works. And then just the colorway fucking, you know, fell in love with it. But it has to be the New Balance Double Taps. I mean, just, you know, the king of the best collaboration program across the whole fucking year.
Yeah, that's the cream of the crop. And then just real quickly, when James and I were putting together, you know, all of the potential options for sneaker of the year, it really is, it's all collabs, besides probably the Yeezy Foam Runner, which you could argue is a collab between Nike and Adidas. I mean, we're talking about fucking Ben and Jerry's Chunky Dunkies. We're talking about Dior Jordan 1s. We're talking about Off-White Jordan 5s, Off-White Jordan 4s, because the sales came out. I had forgotten about those. You have the Supreme Nike Air Force 1 program, which kind of like is an amazing way to kind of treat collabs, which brings me to my final honorable mention. I wouldn't want to move on without shouting out the kind of evolution of the relationship between Kiko and ASICS, where they did, you know, these amazing collabs throughout the years that finally ended. But this idea of taking a designer who has helped kind of mold and shape the culture of a sneaker company and bringing him and his team in-house and being like, listen, man, we obviously respect all the work that you've done for us, and we respect the power that your name brings to the table, but we just want you to freak inline fucking general release stuff, whether that's from scratch from a design standpoint or just colorways, and just help change this brand from the inside. That to me feels like the future of where collaborations can go. So you don't need to just slap Jerry Lorenzo or fucking Virgil Abloh's name on something, even though like those guys do good work. This is what it is. I think that just finally
exact maneuver you just saw that happen with Jerry Lorenzo.
Yes, with
and
Jerry
Adidas.
And Adidas. And right, probably because Nike was like, no, we're not going to, I'm sure it's the size of the bag. And also because probably Nike was not as ready to empower and embrace him in a way that he was looking to forward. But yo, one of my favorite sneakers of the year was the ASICS UB1-S Gel Kyano 14. Yes, I am just reading that off of the headline, but that was Kiko and ASICS bringing a model out of the archive, and he just fucking, you know, they were re-releasing it, and he and his team freaked a couple colorways for men's and women's, and now that shoe, one, you can still like buy that shoe in a lot of sizes. It's not like some sold-out collab. And two, it basically set them up to now bring out more kind of dope colorways moving forward that aren't going to be sold out off rip. So shout out fucking ASICS, right, and shout out Kiko.
Enough sneaker talk, Lawrence. I know that you had to get off another bonus 7 minutes honorable mention after announcing your winner. Let's move on to our personal favorite non-sneaker of the year. Chuck and Chef, I don't know if we told you guys that we were going to do this, so it's totally cool if you guys don't have a non-sneaker of the year. Does anyone have one that wants to go first? Don't all jump at once.
I'll reprise my shout out for Subus.
Yeah, okay.
In this category, because it's more appropriate.
Agreed.
And then besides that, I mean, like, dude, this year has been the year of the Boston for me too, because of the fucking quick like walks down the block to the bodega for beer and cigarettes. So those
Chuck, non-sneaker of the year,
Boston's. Yeah.
I was all right, I'm gonna Boston's. I'm gonna piggyback off that. And for me, it's the clog. The clog is the non-sneaker of the year. Obviously, Birkenstock Bostons were the go-tos and the fucking foundation. But then we were talking about this. Beatniks, I don't think they're a sneaker. I think it's more of a clog or a mule. I think the sneaker's kind of like...
Beatniks are so sick.
Can you run at like close to full speed in a shoe? If you can't, it's not a sneaker. Beatniks, Birks... And not just basic perks.
Beatniks
like,
have that strap though. Beatniks have that strap on the
can't
back.
Can't fucking
back.
Run in Beatniks. Maybe that's our next video content is racing.
Can I walk up the stairs in Beatniks? And if I can,
four wheel drive.
Yeah,
exactly. Put that shit in fucking off road mode.
Can you
baby.
Run up the stairs? Burke's not only like foundational wear for like the Stussy collab, which I know is a little underwhelming. The fucking Chrome Hearts Burks became like grail item of the year, and I know that that's a weird like Chrome Hearts thing. But like J.W. Anderson did his fucking, he freaked the Burks.
Those sucks though. Those suck, dude.
Aurora James, your neighbor at Brother Velly's, did the cow print joints.
Those
which are
bangers.
Fucking hard. And then just kind of like other shoes that I would put in the clog category. You have the Arlogache Mules. You have Crocs. Crocs are clogs. You have my personal favorite. Well, I'll go to Lawrence. You had the Hathenbruck Chilis. That's a fucking clog.
Chilbies, baby.
Chilbies.
Yeah,
my shit. All summer was the Malibu sandals, which were just like backless woven nylon joints. So to me, it's the clog. It was the slip-on, slip-off easiness of it. It was like the heftiness of it, where kind of what I was alluding to with like the Stussy Nike. It's not some crazy fucking giant fashion sneaker, but it's not some like sleek, dainty little joint that, you know, it looks where you need like no break. You can wear clogs with shorts. You can wear the big pants, small pants, whatever. So for me, again, non-sneaker of the year, the clog.
Just generally speaking.
Are those 4S slippers with the backyard chopped off? Those haven't come out yet, right?
I don't believe so.
I don't believe so. Angelo works on his own schedule.
Yeah, those will be out for spring, I think.
I have a very dumb question.
What's that
off for you guys who are a lot smarter than me? What's the difference between a mule and a clog?
I don't know, to be honest. I think
the world may never know. I think it's one of those things where like, are all mules clogs, but all or are all clogs mules, like one of those type beats. You know, I think it just depends what you want to call it.
I think a mule might have a bit of a raised heel.
Interesting.
Or maybe it's the other way around, where a clog is kind of like a flat, and then a clog is a flat, and I think a mule has a bit of a heel. So you see that in the Legaches. In like more kind of like fashion shit, but I think at this point they're like interchangeable.
Yeah, it's a term that at this point people are just using. I think for me, I'm absolutely on Team Subu. It's probably the piece of footwear that I've worn the most. Primarily,
arguably indoors. A clog.
Yeah. So Subu's for me, and then shout out the homies at Subu. Shout out fucking Kaiza. I'm still looking for the
Subu
collab.
Subu, let's link.
That we already teased, which makes us look bad because now it's not happening. So let's get that going again. Yes, for all we know. And then no one's really mentioned loafers. And obviously we are the post-sneaker world guys. And the only loafers that matters, those dropped. And they were spectacular. And we appreciate everyone who bought in. And I've been wearing the fuck out of those. But I will say... I bought my first pair of Belgians after lusting for many, many years to wear at my wedding. And they have since probably become the most worn footwear that I have in my entire arsenal.
Lawrence, how long ago was your wedding?
That was in March 2019. Okay. I got married March 30th, 2019. I'm reading a post.
I am very shocked. Yeah, you're reading off the headline. I'm very shocked. you do wear the Belgians quite often.
They're great. They really are. And listen, Belgians are not cheap, and I understand that they are out of a lot of people's price range. With that said, like, Belgian now apparently has e-com, and they're trying to kind of modernize the brand. And when I say Belgians, I mean actual Belgian brand loafers, not like the people that rip off that style. That, for me, that's the king of footwear. I wear it with double knees. I wear it sockless with fucking short. The only time you can't wear it really is if it's really raining or if it's fucking freezing or it's snow. So right now they're kind of taking a breather, but yeah, I will be buying many more pairs of Belgian loafers in my lifetime. So that's always going to be number one for you.
All right, moving on to next category. Look, if 2020 has given us the opportunity to do anything, it's to pour a whole bunch of fucking shit into the ears of the front of the face.
Yes.
Just chugging those eye beers. I mean, I've watched a fucking record amount of TV.
Wait, Chuck, you're raising your hand.
Movies. I want to go.
Well, Chuck, I think you're up. So we're doing personal favorite TV show of the year. We decided not to forego movies because, like, not that much shit came out, or if it did, it was like so fucked.
I've rewatched Tenet twice since we last talked about it. Big fan.
Garbage. Okay. yeah, it's trash. But I think movie-wise, we rewatched a lot of shit that, like, yeah, was, you know,
classics.
Like, I watched Crimson Tide last night, right? Yeah. But a lot of TV came out this year, and a lot of TV was kind of pushed up to meet the demand. Chuck, you seem enthused. What were you pouring into the ears of the front of the face, my guy?
Because for me, it wasn't even close. Ooh. And it moved me in many ways. And that was How To with John Wilson.
Yo!
Favorite show of the fucking year. So season good. 2 coming soon.
So what's your favorite episode? Was your favorite episode the season finale?
Yes, Mama. And I cried. I was very...
Which one was Risotto?
That was the season finale.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's that incredible.
Like, just the part with his landlord, like, I don't know. I just, like, thought about my grandma and just, like, not seeing her. I don't know. It was just a very, very good episode. The whole season was fucking hilarious. I can't wait for season 2.
The season finale was very fucking good. However, my friend Dick Sucking Ron has this problem that's really annoying, in that he'll alter the way you watch something. He used to just straight up spoil plots, which was fucking annoying and obnoxious. But now he just will kind of, like, alter the way. So I went into that, and he's like, this was, like, the greatest. And people are saying that, like, Jesus tweeted, like, this is the greatest half hour of television of all time. So I go into that expecting that, and it's hard to, like, meet that, those expectations. So for me, the best episode was the circumcision episode.
Yeah. The Mandela Effect one was crazy, too. That one was real great.
It was. For anyone who hasn't seen it, it's most, like, love letters to New York, I think, are fucking corny because they're, like, too saccharine and, like, too sweet and too, like,
he's
rom-com.
Sincere as fuck, bro.
But
he's
this
so
was just
sincere.
Like, it was a love letter to the city, but it was to New York and New York, the people of New York, but it was very much, like, embracing the ugliness and the shittiness of New York and, like, why it's so hard here. Right?
Really? You think so? My thing was, like, anybody who's a New Yorker will talk to anybody if they think you're going to be on TV. like truly.
That's really
like he was saying he got releases for, like, most people.
Yeah,
like,
I mean, that was very clear to me. I will say that I think that Nathan For You is so funny, and Nathan Fielder is a fucking legend. That show is great. At its worst, though, he is laughing at, not potentially with, the subjects, whereas
a few times,
what John Wilson has been able to do is to, it really feels like a sincere embrace of its subjects, even when they're at their most unhinged, i.e. the Mandela Effect episode with that fucking guy, the grocery store inventory homie who hosts the convention or whatever later.
There's a similar charge towards John Wilson where it's kind of like, we are voyeuristically laughing at them and not kind of, but then at its sweetest, it is like, you are, you know, it, like the guy that, like, teaches them how to make risotto, the, like, Italian dude.
But that guy, but I honestly felt like that was very much like a Dude's Rock moment where, like, that guy is just fucking, I don't know. I get what you're saying.
He believes in aliens.
Yeah, that with the ancient alien shit. Well, things did take a left turn, as obviously they're going to.
Chef, what about you? What was your favorite show?
I mean, How To is on my list too. I just think he had a really interesting way of inserting himself into the narrative too, which I really liked. But beyond that, I'd say this year, fucking with the ambient TV, heavy. So I'd say it started with me with Never Have I Ever, Mindy Kaling's 30-minute sitcom series that came out on Netflix. I'll throw Emily in Paris on there. Yeah, dude.
Pure junk food.
Like, it was good. Yeah, man.
Briz Black.
Yeah, we left it off. Well, okay, let's make a note. Let's add Emily in Paris to the survey. James and I were like, nobody actually liked this, so we didn't include it, but clearly we
I think me and both of my roommates, at least, we all really enjoyed it. For reality TV, Summer House Season 4 slaps. The challenge, Total Madness, which is at the beginning of the year, and Double Agents, which is airing right now. Both seasons have been fucking gas. Selling Sunset Season 2 was pretty fire.
Wait, that was season 3 came out this year, right?
Or season 3, excuse me. Yeah. Whichever season came out this year was hella good. And then for actual TV, I May Destroy You, number 1. Industries on the list, and then how to with John Wilson was number 3.
All right. I went first last time. Lawrence, you want to go?
Yeah, sure. I mean, there's a lot here. I think that I love The Boys. I consumed The Boys season 1 and 2 as kind of like a straight through kind of double feature of seasons. So obviously I missed that first go around. In terms of fucking, period piece type beat with royalty, love The Crown and love The Great on Hulu. I've talked about The Great extensively on this podcast. Obviously, it's much funnier than The Crown. It has fucking workplace comedy elements, as wild as that sounds as well. Elle Fanning.
Oh, yeah.
And Nicholas Holt. Yeah, yeah. I love that show. Big How To with John Wilson, like everyone else. Let's not forget that The Last Dance and Tiger King, both high art documentary filmmaking, happened
Carol Baskin
in 2020. And my most ultimate recency bias show that I loved, I know Chef can back me up in terms of sincere, wonderful shit, Ted Lasso. Really, I had no idea how much I was going to enjoy it. With that said, the best show of the year, because of my three favorite things: sex, drugs, and money. Industry, heads and shoulder above anything that I have watched personally since Succession. It's not TV, it's HBO. Give me Industry season 2 expeditiously.
Drop the merch.
Dude, season one, like, just the finale just aired last night.
Give me more. Well, don't give a shit.
So that was really crazy. I happened to follow the co-creators of the show, and they may follow me back for.
Oh, come on.
I don't know why.
Are you going to do right now what I think you're going to do?
No, I'm not. But what I'm saying is that they've been touting all this press. I'm like, wait, what the fuck? And I guess it just ended in the UK, and it is now becoming a buzzer beater top 10 on a lot of critics lists.
The best show of the year. So good.
Industry way up there. For me, I got to shout out Big Mouth, the Fairy Pod Mother's favorite show. So fucking funny. And season 4 found its legs again. I May Destroy You, like Chef said. Do you guys fuck with 000, this drug show on Amazon that took place in Italy, Mexico?
You and Big Scorp, dude. Watched it.
Go watch this shit. This shit is this felt like Nolan-esque. It just felt like big and expensive and multiple timelines, multiple storylines happening all together. How To John Wilson, Tiger King, The Last Dance. Yes. Also, with docuseries, I'd put up Cheer. You guys remember Cheer?
Yeah. Was that this year?
Yeah.
Fuck.
RIP my guy Jerry. You're not RIP, but he's a fucking pedo, I guess.
RIP to your freedom, dog. Yeah. And is he in jail?
I think he's awaiting
sentencing.
The whole thing is getting played out. Yeah, it sucks.
Yeah, well, he's
for reality, where am I? Below Deck Med. This past season was fucking crazy, where Chief Stew Hannah got booted off the ship for her Vikes and CBD pen.
That was
and the
crazy.
Fucking
That's
like.
Girl. Well, first of all, her CBD pen. Come on, bro.
And there's all this other fucking drama. It was wild. It was really wild. And other reality, I've never watched a Real Housewives franchise. Real Housewives of Salt Lake City is fucking bananas. There's insane. Grandfather fucking. There's like weird, you know, race purity shit. There's the grandfather fucker consistently wears a Gucci beret with like Chanel gloves, which is like atrocious. It's wild. Industry, yes, like that is the most like cannot look away. Need to fucking binge it all right now. And then the other top show, you know, co-tie for first place or tie for first place for me is What We Do in the Shadows as a comedy. Yeah. You guys know this?
Familiar. Yeah, I've seen the movie.
I've seen the movie too. Yeah. Taika, right?
Taika and one of the guys from the fucking New Zealand guitar guys.
The Flight of the Conchords.
Flight of the Conchords.
Yes, that guy.
Jerome, not Brit. Yeah. Vampires living in Staten Island. It's just like charming. It's hopeful. It's great. Like you actually fall in love with the characters a little bit and start to care about
them. Ted Lasso, I think, is how I would kind of
Ted Lasso. I tried watching the first episode. I could not get into it. And
really? Oh, okay. That's fair.
What we do in the shadows.
It's a dad show, man. Like I've been. Wow.
It might be like reflective of my old age to some degree. Yeah.
Also, it was my cousin in Princeton, father of two babies, recommended to me.
Jason Statham is in the, and I know you're not supposed to judge a show off a pilot. Like you have to like give it, you know, two or three episodes, but like, I just cannot get past his like, oh, well, I guess we're still going to try.
His dude, like well, yokel, like, hopeful yokel type shit. Yeah.
It was like a web series or like some like web content and people just like loved it. So they decided.
So he played a character for NBC Sports that was like, you know, they used as like a fucking mascot prop for like Premier League promotion. And I guess they used the IP and they sold the IP and they turned it into a whole fucking series. And I expected
it was good.
I will say this, and sure, recency bias, 1,000% hand up. I just watched it. But I will say
it melted your cold little heart.
My cold little Grinch heart that was fucking 69 sizes too small. I didn't think it would even remotely fucking tickle my pickle, and it fucking hit, dude.
Honestly, like, I'm pretty
alligator tears at various moments. Like it rocked, dude.
I'm pretty shocked, man. That's very cool that you.
Thank you. Thank you for saying I'm very cool, Jeff.
It's funny, like
across
every category, it seems like we are almost like batting 1,000 when it comes to like at least two people agreeing on their or having like a tie, which is just speaks to like just how close the homies are. I want to throw it to naturally we threw it to Chuck first last time. This is Chef's time to shine. We're going to talk personal favorite musical artists of the year.
Fuck yeah.
Chef, try to keep it to 15 minutes.
Which, by the way, just real quick, Chef's top 50 songs of 2020, Chef Jams number 8. Whether this comes out
in
on Thursday
now.
Or Friday, that shit, Trap Lord in stores now. This it'll is why you are a patron. Listen to that shit.
Okay. Yeah, it'll be out the top 50. I mean, I can't pick a favorite. I can't pick one single favorite, but I will say that like
pick 50.
it's been like two there are like two camps, right? Like new releases from this year and then just like older shit that I got into. And I would say like for like newer stuff that came out this year in terms of albums, I mean like as like a cohesive project, I think Phoebe Bridgers had the most bangers on her album out of most people, so that one, you know, is up there. I fucked with the Haim album a lot, Women in Music Part 3. Like, that one gets a lot of play in our apartment. And then Waxahachie, I think also, like, that record was, like, one of my favorites of this year. And then beyond that, I mean, like, Chicano Batman, who actually prior to this year, I never really liked, or I never really, like, listened to them that much. But the singles for this new album that they put out this year were awesome. And I just, like, ended up getting into their entire back catalog, too, because of, like, what came out this year. So I'd recommend them. And then the Strokes record, which I know like a lot of people did not like. Honestly, dude, like I've been listening to it a lot and I think that there's like three or four songs on it that are just like very like classic Strokes canon like songs that I fucking love. Yeah, and in terms of like old stuff, I've talked about both of these guys or maybe at least like one of them on pod before, but I think I went through two really deep phases this year. one, Guided by Voices this summer. Like I got super into them and I love them. I would start with Alien Lanes. Like that's like, it's like a 27, 28 song record, but it's still less than like 30 minutes. Every song is like a minute and a half. And it's like, it's just perfect to like get a sense of like all the different flavors that a band has to offer. So would recommend that. And then the second is the Jesus and Mary Chain, which I just sent an album to James.
Supreme collaborators.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, dude. I mean, they fucking rule. I mean, I love.
Oh, wait, no, I'm thinking of My yeah. Bloody Valentine. Sorry. My apologies.
Yeah. I mean, they were the predecessors to My Bloody Valentine.
Sure. Whatever. Like,
Use noise, a lot of feedback, like, you know, like shoegaze.
The posy Larry. Yeah, it's like a pre-shoegaze, yeah.
But yeah, Darklands, their second album, I think. Yeah, that one I've been listening to like nonstop for the last few months. But yeah.
Wait, who is your new music? Who is your definitive artist of the year? Is it Phoebe Bridgers?
Yeah. I mean, if I had to pick one artist that put out new music this year, yes, that I liked the most, I would say Phoebe. And I think that also, like, her press run was insane. She got covered in literally every single publication, I think, that, like, that matters.
People's Champ.
Almost overwhelming. But because she is so funny and self-aware and just, like, you know.
She's on TikTok now.
Yeah, she has a good personality. And
she went on Corporate Dunce. That's, I mean, you know, maybe not the best look as the only podcast that matters.
Unprecedented press run.
Unprecedented.
Yo, she's cool as shit. She did, I mean, yeah, even like, you know, even her Playboy like fucking feature amazing, you know. I'll give it to her again.
All right,
respect.
One vote for Phoebe. Chuck.
Chuck.
So I think like my favorite, the album that I listened to the most was definitely How I'm Feeling Now by Charlie XCX. But I was thinking about it and like, artist of the year, like, I think you have to give credit to producers, and The Alchemist had an insane year.
Yeah,
like, Alk, dude.
How long has he? I haven't listened to anything he did probably like 2010. I mean, I'm sure I have, but just not realized it. But it's just like, how in 2020 is he still like? I mean, he made some of my favorite things, like the Boldy James shit was great. Freddie Gibbs, obviously now Grammy nominated, like. I just think that he had an insane year, and when I think about like 2020 as a whole, like I'm like, damn, like, I mean, he was working all year and he killed everything he did.
Anyone else, Chuck, or are you just you're gonna stick with? Because I know you are both Freddie Gibbs guys. So shout out Gangsta Gibbs. Even if I will admit that I prefer Bandana to Alfredo, I think that it's sick that Freddie kind of, I don't know, not that he transcended, because he has been a very popular guy. A little, if you know, you know, but it's very cool to see. That's probably the one bright spot in the Grammys for me personally. But is there anything else, anyone else that you want to shout out?
I've listened to their music mostly through Charlie XCX, but my homie John reminded me that A.G. Cook put out some great solo shit this year. And I think they should definitely be considered. And probably will be one of my most bumped artists when it's all said and done. Shout out to producers.
Yeah.
Shout out to producers, dude. The guys behind the guys.
The Grom, the rapper Groms, if you will.
Exactly. Rasta, man. The Groms of hip hop, bro.
All right, Larry, who is your personal favorite musical artist of the year 2020?
All right, so
past year in recent history.
Yeah, so I'm definitely with Chuck, big Gangster Gibbs guy myself. This was definitely the year that maybe this is speaking to what Chef said about me and my fucking dad humor falling in love with Ted Lasso, but not just Freddie, who's a little bit older, but Griselda, man. I mean, Benny the Butcher, the project that he put out of all the Griselda guys and all these dudes fucking, you know, put bars on wax this year, West Side Gun, Conway the Machine, but Benny and Burden of Proof, that project probably bumped that the most. I definitely, that's unexpected, right? Like that's not what I would normally gravitate to. So I think that speaks to my maturity ? Shout out fucking Lil Uzi Vert, Eternal Take, finally out. I wear more Supreme than a hype beast. The deluxe to me was better than the OG. With that said, that didn't hit like I hoped it would. And my general point with hip hop this year, at least mainstream hip hop, was this might be the most disappointing year
in recent memory. Obviously 21 in Metro, you know, Savage Mode 2 was fire. I feel like Morgan Freeman really kind of like elevated, like without Morgan Freeman, I feel like I'm not going back to that project, which is funny because like, I'm not a big skits guy. I'm not, you know, the baby to me is like, meh. Big Scorp didn't really do anything this year. Shout out Lil Baby. Lil Baby did, I think, have an impressive year though. I don't know, man. I kind of expected more from like the dude that that you know, a lot of people think is next up. So really what it comes down to, and I can't believe I'm going to admit this, but my favorite project of the year and is fucking Folklore. And I got to shout out fucking Tay Swizzle, dude.
That's what you're fucking leading up to is Taylor Swift. Oh my God. You need to work on
your
really
brevity, my
Griselda,
guy. But Taylor Swift is definitely my favorite.
Yo, my favorite song.
Yo, the only person more prolific than your ranting is Taylor Swift.
What did you think of the second one?
Yeah, no, not so Evermore didn't really hit for. Well, first of all, I have not been a Taylor Swift fan at all. Folklore I just loved it. The Last Great American Dynasty, as we've talked about, or as I've talked about in the pod, favorite track of the year. Didn't really give a fuck about Evermore, and who knows if a third's coming out. So yeah, for me, I'm really hoping that I really hope that A Whole Lot of Red restores balance to the force so that I don't look like a fucking dweeb on mic any more than I already have. The fact that he got Kid Cudi on Kid Cudi, aka Pissy Pamper, already kind of makes me want to eat my words from last week.
Trash though. Yeah.
Oh, come on.
I meant to send it to another group chat and I accidentally ended up sending it to James and I was
I want him to think that I actually like this. Expectations, but as I said last week publicly because of the
you like that Cudi's on the Cardi album?
I don't
No, I'm talking to Lawrence. I know that you and I agree. I'm talking to Lawrence.
First of all, the there's so many amazing Cardi songs that no one knows if they'll see the light of day. Molly, fucking Pissy Pamper, which was obviously a young nudie song, which they couldn't clear the sample, but apparently Ye came in and cleared the sample. They got fucking Kid Cudi on there. You know, I smoke more dope than fucking Kid Cudi. Put Cudi on the fucking feature. Fingers crossed. I'm hoping that I can eat my words and that will be the true fucking gift on Christmas. Whole Lot of Red. Yeah, for the most part, bad year for hip hop. Shout out fucking Taylor Swift, iconic singer-songwriter. Folklore, right. Record of the year.
All right, I'm going to do a few kind of subcategories. My album of the year, Sa Baby. Just barnacles.
Oh, yes. Okay, right. Sa Baby.
That's in the top 50.
Bitch, we go motherfucking barnacles. That's not prolific.
Let me speak. You just spoke for like 15,000 seconds.
Shout out Sa Baby.
That was a huge vibe. And again, just this is all personal, right? So for me, that was like when I was, when the weather started warming up and I started like doing like hour-long bike rides, that's what I would put in my ears and I would just fucking float and like be able to climb hills and just like, it was a whole, tell you a single like song title because I would just listen to it front to back two times. And it was
it
just
feels
a whole
like
fucking,
one thing, like one
exactly.
giant.
I would just sick. Float. Like I never, right. like it didn't matter what awesome. He was saying. It was just a whole fucking vibration.
Bitch, with motherfucking barnacles.
The throwback in my feels of the year is I guess they put out two albums, but I just like made me go back into their fucking discographies. The Mountain Goats. Chef, are you aware of the Mountain Goats?
Yeah.
I had a nice little bonding moment with Nick Weinfeld, the homie behind Neo Yokio.
The goat.
I posted some like, I tried rewatching Moral Oral, which is like a classic banger that I think is on HBO Max. And he was like, yo, like I worked on that and I fought so hard. I was like, yo, that's crazy. And they actually got me to the Mountain Goats. He's like, what? That's crazy. I was the guy that fought so hard to get the Mountain Goats in like the series finale or season finale when like some really fucked up shit happens and like the Mountain Goats comes in. I was like, oh my God, that's, we bonded over that. Rockstar of the year. Where the fuck is Mario Judah?
Oh, sure. Yeah.
Breakout. I cannot wait for this guy, what he's coming with in 2021. His cover of Rockstar trumps the babies. And this is like a fucking classic 2020. I mean, this guy like had a viral song on TikTok, which is so ridiculous. It like became fucking huge. And then he's just a character that is larger than life and is, I mean, the most entertaining part of this whole lot of red run-up for me has been like Mario Judah being like, drop the fucking tape or I'm releasing my own bitch.
Should that be the outro music? Be ya? That shit fucking rocks, dude. That slaps.
Well, I want to make a case for this. My single of the year, late fucking entry. Troy Sylvan, I think.
Easy.
What?
No, I was just singing it.
Troy Sylvan, this gay Australian YouTuber turned pop star, featuring Casey Musgrave's
Easy. Yeah.
Mark Ronson. Don't forget the
and Mark Ronson, the purest fucking banger. And
great
he was,
video too. Great video.
Yo, so I guess we'll get to best dressed celebs of the year. I've heard this guy and I was always like dismissive, like, oh psh, whatever, like, yeah, YouTube star turned pop star, whatever. This dude
because
you're
homophobic, obviously.
No, because I'm anti-mainstream, baby. But this was the year that I got to like TikTok and like the way that you kind of went dad, I went like, you know, like angsty teen where I'm like getting onto TikTok and like more embracing of like shit that doesn't necessarily make sense to me, but you give it a shot and you're like, okay, even if this isn't what I like, what my brain developed to, like I can understand the appeal here. And that's why like Mario Judah being just a fucking rock star and Troy Sylvan, what's his name?
Troy Sylvan.
Just being a fucking, you know, I just want to, you know, do ecstasy of the shit. But then my artist of the year, Eternal Take Deluxe, did not necessarily blow my dick off, but I think that Lil Uzi Vertical, artist of the year with the deluxe album, I think it had enough bangers where it like in today's day and age, like constituted like a pretty successful project. And then just like, The shit with Future. And somebody tweeted today, and I think it made a good, a lot of sense, where it's like, Uzi currently is the bridge between the old shit, which, you know, you now have to put Future into like the old head, not old 100%. Head, but like older rapper currently.
Yeah.
But he's doing features with all these artists that I would have no fucking idea who they are unless they had an Uzi feature. And you know that he is like A&R Uzi, and, you know, trying to put on or, you know, be aligned with like the next big breakout star. And just like, he's the only person whose IG live I'll still tune into, no offense, Chuck, because he's just like a fucking entertaining dude, and like his love for his passion for fashion is like you know, unparalleled. I just love that little fucking goblin. So yeah, overall, like well-rounded artist here for me, it's still got to be Lil Uzi Vertical.
One guy that we haven't mentioned, so a couple big picture points here. Definitely the one of the best years, I think, for women in music, really taking fucking center stage. We haven't mentioned Megan Thee Stallion. We haven't mentioned fucking Dua Lipa, you know?
Sakamami,
for sure.
Flo Milli shit.
I think Flo Milli definitely is poised to have a huge 2021. But with all that said, we haven't mentioned The Weeknd, who obviously like got snubbed by the Grammys and there's all that beef. I do think that The Weeknd really, while we've seen stars, Kanye West, you know, we've seen these icons fall off, or even someone like Drake kind of like not release anything or maybe kind of temper the expectations with what's coming up with Certified Lover Boy. I really think that The Weeknd, when it comes down to it, like, this dude reinventing himself, changing his look, not on like some Bowie shit, but who else do we have right now that can kind of change the sound, change the look, you know,
Bad Bunny.
completely fucking pivot. Yeah. Besides Bad Bunny. So I just wanted to shout out The Weeknd. I mean, you know, fucking,
oh, and we got to mention RIP Pop Smoke. I mean,
oh God, you know, obviously RIP and also shout out the next generation of drill that will use fucking Pop Smoke's Eternal Swagger, 5EO and fucking all these dudes that are going to take, you know, New York drill, hopefully to the next level. So I think that more or less is the bow on the music convert.
All right. Approaching 2 hours here. Let's get into what will most definitely be the shortest segment, because it's the least amount, the shallowest pool to pull from, which is personal favorite best dressed celebrity of the year. Mm-hmm. We all know that celebrities, except for our guy, Jonah Hill, cannot dress themselves. Mm-hmm. So this is actually tough. Chuck, Chef, I guess we went to Chuck first. Chef, why don't we go to you? Oh, no, sorry. We went to Chef first. Chuck, let's go to you.
No, we can go to Chef. Honestly, like,
is it a pass? You could say pass. It's fine.
You get. I mean, this one we're done here. So it's kind of like, was there a celeb that kind of tickled your pickle at all in terms of like fits and pap photos or any personal style, whatever?
I mean, the crazy thing is there just like weren't as many pap photos this year.
Sure, that's fair
because of quarantining. But also, I mean, obvious choice: Harry Styles, the fucking goat, in his videos and everything. I think he's cool. The Brad Pitt flannel moment.
Yeah, sure. Fire. Brad Pitt had a great year for sure.
His hair.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's on, I mean, he's the most handsome man ever. He's on the fucking survey for sure.
Yeah. And then, I would say that I always have really fucked with, not always, but recently in the last like 4 or 5 years, I've always been fucking with, Tyler, the Creator. And I think that he's always,
he's well dressed.
Yeah. I wish people would stop being like, he dresses like a swaggy grandpa. It's like, no, he just dresses well.
No, he's
and,
cool.
And the fact that he's a rapper sets these like probably implicitly racist expectations of where you're like, oh, like he's really breaking the mold. It's like,
sure.
Yes, but also he's just fucking dressed well. Stop calling him a swaggy grandpa.
I saw him. It was literally at the beginning of this year, like pre-COVID. Do you guys remember where there was like one like random weekend in like January or February where it was like 60 degrees in New York and everybody was like out? Maybe not. I was at Mast Books in the East Village and I saw him and Frank Ocean there. They were both just like chilling outside.
Who had the better fit?
Like, what's up?
Who had the better fit?
Tyler had the better fit. He was wearing like just like, you know, like the classic like burgundy pants. He was wearing this like satin bomber jacket. And then he had like an ascot, like a floral like ascot like tied around his neck. And he just looked cool as fuck. And yeah, since then I've just been.
Frank did not post on Instagram like because James and I were putting the list together. Frank is not on the list because I don't know if we even saw any pics. Was Frank wearing the green bandana? Was that this year, 2020? Because that was like a fucking dope fit. When he was on a bike and he had like the fucking bandana tied like biker style, if you know, like just like kind of classic. But Frank didn't really post at all, so there no fit pics, no selfies. So
I know, yeah,
he
I
didn't
know
make the list,
about.
But yeah, I don't know. Maybe
he
Frank
definitely wasn't
be
wearing
matted.
It that day. He lost his younger brother this year, though. So you know,
that's right. Fuck, dude. You know,
he's been off the radar.
Condolences to the blonded homie. Chuck, do you have you thought of anybody that you see in an aspirational sense in terms of celeb style, or are you gonna punt this completely?
Just the homies, really. Like, yeah, honestly. Hell yeah. Like I was thinking about it, like I thought that I had discovered everyone who's like has like aspirational style already. Like I'm just like, we've had so many people on the podcast, but like Aaron Levine is someone who I've like talked to about sneakers a lot, and I just like I'm like, damn, like I said, like I thought I had discovered all the Fitzmen of the world, but then
there's always another Fitzman, baby.
You guys come out with Aaron Levine.
We don't die, we multiply, bitch.
Yeah. So shout out to him.
Yo, Aaron honestly has some of the best fits. I wouldn't say Aaron is like a celebrity, maybe to you, Chuck. But shout out Aaron for sure. James, what about you? Is there anyone that really fucking stands out or anybody?
No, they all suck. there's been, I don't know where this editorial is, but there's been this editorial going around of Willem Dafoe looking fucking snazzy. He's wearing like awesome. A Yankees fitted. He's wearing like a sweater vest tucked into some shit. Like he just looks so fire. And to me, like, and then there aren't really.
Wait, so that's a Willem Dafoe.
That's an honorary
editorial
mention. That's
from another
mention.
Magazine where he wore the outfits of the people that are participating on the shoot. So he wore the hairdresser style. Or the hairdresser's fit. He wore the stylist fit. It's a genius idea, but that's what you're talking about. And yo, shout out Willem Dafoe. Famously, walked the Prada runway. Whenever in spring summer 20.
He's like the Galaxy Brain.
He rocks.
What's the Jeff? What's his name that fucking wore the Prada and like you
Goldblum?
Know, Jeff Goldblum. Where it's like, all right, we get it. Like you fucking have some shirts. Right, he's like the Galaxy Brain version of that, where it's like Jeff Goldblum stuff.
Well, he was on the Prada runway with like Gary Oldman and a bunch of other celebs, and Jeff Goldblum only just fucking you know bought it in store later. So.
Yeah, and then was like, oh, I'm Jeff Goldblum. But again, I'm gonna throw it back to my boy from favorite musical artist of the year. No, not Mario Giuda, although he should get an honor mention. My guy Troy. Someone was like, yo, Troy has appropriated Jacksonville twink culture. In the latest video where he's in like high heels, shirtless, and short jorts.
And then I was like going through shit. Yeah. And again, yeah, the cutoffs. And like this guy just fucking, he's hot as shit. Like he dresses very interestingly. You can tell it's his own taste. You can tell he's like has a 360 mind when it comes to aesthetics. And he's not just like fucking chasing the big brands and all that shit. So like, again, I there's no like standout moments. There's no like, you know, singular fit that got fucking papped up that stands out, obviously, with, you know, no one being outside. But I think that Troy, I'm looking to this kid for, yeah, just like awesome things in 2021 based on what I saw in 2020.
Sick.
What about you, so, big Lair Bear?
So I'm with Chef. Tyler always is up there. I definitely prefer that kind of swag to someone like Rocky, who is always going to get fits off and is always going to be at the molten hot center of a lot of fashion conversations because of like the actual product that he's either creating himself or collabing on. I will say that me specifically, I sucked his dick on the Kyle pod, but yo, fucking ASAP Nast. I don't know if he's like, if we consider him a celebrity, I don't know if he has, I don't know what the cutoff is there, whether you need like a million followers on IG or whatever. And I know Nast doesn't make a ton of music anymore, but I think that Nast style, his personal style is truly incredible. And if you follow him on Instagram, he definitely holds himself in high esteem and talks about a lot of clothes and brands and swag like he invented it, which is pretty obnoxious. But with that said, he gets huge fucking fits off. And then, yeah, my little honorable mention, I think Skepta, Big Smoke, man. I mean, just fucking hot, cool, fucking bangers for days. Just a dude that I think represents, you know, a lot of positive aspirational qualities that I think guys and girls can look for. I mean, his confidence is infectious. So just wanted to shout out Big Smoke and hopefully we'll have some new music from him in the new year. Some new fashion related stuff as well, where he'll kind of take front and center where he deserves to be. So those would be kind of my shout outs.
All right, let's fucking go 180 and let's get into our personal bozos of the year. Again, this is hard. Unlike best dressed celeb, this is hard because there were so many to choose from in 2020. And obviously, like, politics was a fucking endless waterfall, a deluge of bozos, you know, left and right.
Embarrassment of riches.
Chuck, why don't we go to you since you kicked it to Chef last time. Who's your personal biggest bozo of the year?
Billionaires. Just any of them. Fuck all of them. Because it's like, if you have that much money, why wouldn't you just buy us all healthcare?
Facts.
Like, what's in it for you? Like, what are you going to do with all that? Come on. Yeah. So all billionaires, specifically Jeff Bezos.
Healthcare is a human right.
Fuck Jeff Bezos. Jeff Bozos.
Jeff Bozos. They shipping on that ass.
Yeah.
All right, Chef, who's your bozo of the year?
You know, this was like kind of hard to think about at first, but then like when it came to me, I was like, yes, this is the one. You guys know the video of that girl in Miami that was like getting interviewed by the guy, and he was like, "What's your body count?" And she's like, 3 McChickens, but her voice is just like fucking, you know, like super fried. And she's like, "Oh yeah, by the way, I have the coronavirus. That's why my voice sounds like
Queen."
And then it like freezes on him, and like it's a curb music.
Yeah. He's just like. Anyway, yeah, that girl's my
legend.
My personal legend,
dude.
Three friends, Harry McChicken.
You better watch that, Mike. Otherwise, you'll get it too.
Larry, who's your bozo of the year?
Well, there's a lot to choose from. I mean, honestly, kill all politicians, hate them all, fucking kill all billionaires. I echo my man Chuck. Anybody who steals our Patreon knowingly, fuck you. I hope you and your family die of coronavirus. Anybody who has depledged our Patreon for any reason that wasn't kind of, you know, financially based because things have been tougher this year, also go fuck yourself. Everybody who hits me up on fucking Instagram like I'm a goddamn customer service rep and treats me like shit and doesn't say please or thank you when it comes to how things fit or any kind of advice I have for them, fuck you, I hate you, leave me alone. And then finally, I think all of that dovetails into the biggest bozo of the year, which is fucking me. I mean, I quit my job and this is what I'm fucking doing for a living now, so I have no one to blame but myself, which only reinforces more how much I fucking love and appreciate and support my fellow fucking thrill gang who without I couldn't get the pleasure of talking shit for 2 hours with the homies and pay my rent. So the positive and the negative, the plus and the minus, both sides of the coin, the catch 22 that was 2020. A lot of bozos, a lot of heroes. Can only hope that next year will be better.
Yeah, I don't know what the Chinese zodiac sign is for 2020, but it's now the bozo. It's Bozo the Clown is now the official mascot of 2020. I would put up honorable mentions. I would put up Bryce Hall, right? I think this guy is the fucking, first of all, he's stumpy as shit, and I think that he is like
the guy who does the thing with Dave Portnoy, the show with Dave Portnoy?
No, that's Josh Richards.
Okay. That's a different guy.
They're like, whatever. They're both part of Straight TikTok. And Straight TikTok, I think, is this like horrible. They're the fucking jocks in high school that are just like, you know, they're pretty to look at, but they're fucking just horrible. Like all their shit is very homo. All their shit is very homoerotic, which veers into homophobia, where they're like mocking the homoeroticism.
That's a plot of Tenet, right? Is what you're talking about?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. But no, so he's been caught like, you know, fighting people. Like he's not worn masks and like fucking had temper tantrums in restaurants and like fuck shit up and like fought busboys and shit. But kind of like Super Saiyan of him, I would say Logan Paul, Bozo of the Year. Honorable mention, because truly my personal biggest bozo of the year is Elon Musk. He is the Dave Portnoy of tech. He is the current like incel hero. He's like, he's the fucking, you know, like he's people think he's galaxy brain. His stock,
a dumb person's version of a smart guy.
Yeah, like his stock rich, has like risen 700%. Tesla's still like losing money. The whole thing is just very indicative of like all the shit that we've kind of said is wrong, right? Where it's like,
yeah,
cult of personality, late stage capitalism, brand loyalty. You know, this guy's problematic. Like he fucking, unwittingly or not, like spreads conspiracy theories that are just bad. He, you know, breeds this like new breed of like tech bro, rich money worshiping incel motherfucker. And he named his kid a fucking like a sneaker model. So yeah, it's
bleep,
Elon
bleep
Musk.
Blorp. Yeah.
Yeah.
More. Also, we should just say without a doubt, all cops are bozos. Fuck cops everywhere.
Yeah, that's on the cities. That's for you to fill out.
Let's not lose sight of the goals that we set earlier this year of making the world a better place. Ladies and gentlemen, I think that is an official wrap on the Fitties pre-show. This is the pre-show to
survey. This is the critics' Fitties. This is the critics' Fitties.
This was the thought leader kind of critics appetizer to the survey, which will be out Monday, which we hope everybody fucking thinks long and hard about and fills out, at which point we will then kind of recap and review most of these categories, not all of them, on New Year's Day. Can't wait.
All right, Chef, take one of the fucking songs. Hopefully it's Troy and Casey. Slap that motherfucking outro music and take us out to New Year's Day 2021, baby.
You ran away to find something to say. I went astray to make it okay, and he made it easy, darling. I'm still in love, and I say that because